Hatcher leads the A-Sun.
Welcome, baseball fans, to Stillwell Stadium on the campus of Kennesaw State University for this weekend's big A-Sun matchup between the visiting Liberty Flames and the homestanding Kennesaw State Owls. In 2022, the Hunter becomes the Hunted, as last year these two teams squared off in the last two series of the regular season, with the Owls needing four wins to secure a regular season conference championship. That was not to be, as the Liberty Flames won 5 out of 6 of those games to secure the 2021 A-Sun regular season title. The roles are reversed here this weekend, as the Owls come in with an overall 21-10 record and 10-2 in the A-Sun Eastern Division, leading by 3 games over these Liberty Flames, who enter at 20-11 and 7-5 in conference play. I'm Trey Fowler, joined in the booth by Bryce Gobert. And Bryce, this series could come down to strength versus strength.
And Trey, that's the perfect way to describe it. And you got the best pitching staff in the conference in Liberty going up against the best hitting team in the conference in Kennesaw State. Overall, Kennesaw batting .305 in the batter's box. Lead team, you know, getting led by Josh Hatcher. Leads the A-Sun in doubles with 16, hits with 58, and in batting average, with batting a .426 average, versus this pitching staff, who overall, as a pitching staff, have a team ERA of a 3.69, and looking forward to tonight with Garrett Horn, who is second on the team with a 1.65 ERA, 3 wins, 1 loss. It'll definitely be a good matchup here for Kennesaw State, and I think we're going to get a lot of good baseball here tonight.
We are definitely expecting a lot of good baseball tonight and all weekend. If you're joining us, one thing to keep an eye out on for both of these teams this year could be how big of a factor defense plays this weekend. Both teams have had their struggles at times in 2022, and defense many times has been the downfall of each of these teams. So that's something to keep an eye on. Liberty, who led the nation a year ago in fewest errors per game and fielding percentage, struggling a little bit defensively. Now that the stage has been set, we know what's on the line. Let's meet the starting lineups for tonight's action. Game one here from Stillwell Stadium. First for the visiting Flames, leading off the catcher, number 2, Gray Betts. Batting second, the right fielder, number 9, Aaron Anderson. Batting third, the Ace Suns' leading home run man at the moment, number 20, Derek Orndorff. Batting fourth, the left fielder, number 3, 3, Hillier. Batting fifth, the shortstop, number 17, Stephen Hill. Batting sixth, the first baseman, number 55, Logan Matthew. Batting seventh, the freshman third baseman, number 5, Cameron Foster. Batting eighth, the designated hitter, number 23, Brady Gulikowski. And rounding out the Flames order will be the second baseman, number 22, Nathan Keeter. As Bryce mentioned, on the mound for the Flames will be left-handed pitcher, number 14, freshman Garrett Horn. And now the starting line for the home standing Kennesaw State Owls, leading off playing center field, number 13, Josh Hatcher. Batting second, the fifth-year senior, number 2, Tyler Simon. Batting third, the first baseman, number 25, Donovan Cash. Batting fourth, the third baseman, number 4, Cash Young. Batting fifth, the second baseman, number 8, Hudson Mims. Batting sixth, the catcher, number 23, Nick Hassan. Batting seventh, the right fielder, number 21, Braden Edson. Batting eighth, the designated hitter, number 1, Spencer Hansen. And rounding out the Owl order will be the left fielder, number 34, Nick Kalina. On the mound tonight for the Owls will be number 11, Jack Myers. Owls fans may notice that Zach Corbin is not in the lineup, still nursing an injury that he sustained against the University of Georgia on Tuesday night, where he ran into the fence and tweak the hammy. So we'll keep an eye on that this weekend for you. The coaches are meeting at the plate. Scott Jackson, the head coach of Liberty University. Ryan Coe in his first year for Kennesaw State. The home plate umpires and coaches are meeting. We'll be back in just a few moments after the anthem for first pitch of this big Ace Sun weekend series between the Flames and the Owls with first place on the line.
For the starting lineups. First for the visitors from the Liberty Flames. Leading off in catching is number 2, Gray Betts. Batting second and playing right field, number 9, Aaron Anderson. Batting third and playing center field, number 20, Derek Orndorff. Batting fourth and playing left field is number 3 Hillier. Batting fifth and playing shortstop, number 17, Stephen Hill. Batting sixth and playing first base, number 55, Logan Matthew. Batting seventh and playing third base, number 5, Cameron Foster. Batting eighth, designated hitter, number 23, Brady Gulikowski. Batting ninth, playing second base is number 22, Nathan Peter. And pitching for the Flames is number 14, Garrett Horn. The head coach for the Flames is Scott Jackson. And now from the 2022 Kennesaw State Owls. Leading off and playing center field, number 13, Josh Hatcher. Batting second and playing shortstop, number 2, Tyler Simon. Batting third and playing first base, number 25, Donovan Cash. Batting fourth and playing third base, number 4, Cash Young. Batting fifth and playing second base is number 8, Hudson Mims. Batting sixth and catching, number 23, Nick Hassan. Batting seventh and playing right field, number 21, Brayden Edson. Batting eighth, designated hitter, number 1, Spencer Hansen. And batting ninth and playing left field, number 34, Nick Polina. And on the mound for the Owls tonight is number 11, Jack Myers. Your Owls are coached by Ryan Coe. KSU fans, please welcome to the field your 2022 Kennesaw State Owls. Ladies and gentlemen, please join Kennesaw State University and our players and coaches in honoring America and celebrating its freedom and those who protect it. Let us rise as one nation and one people for the playing of our national anthem.
And we are back from Stillwell Stadium for this big A-Sun matchup between the visiting Flames and Kennesaw State Owls. First place on the line this Easter weekend. Let's set the starters defensively for the Owls in left field, number 34, Nick Kalina. In center field, number 13, Josh Hatcher. In right field, number 21, Brayden Edson. At third base, number 4, Cash Young. At shortstop, number 2, Tyler Simon. At second base, number 8, Hudson Mims. At first base, number 25, Donovan Cash. Behind the plate, number 23, Nick Hassan. And on the mound, the grad transfer, number 11, Jack Myers. Myers enters the game, 3-1 on the year, 3.56 ERA in 43 innings. He's given up 39 hits, 17 earned runs, 11 walks, 35 strikeouts, and opponents are hitting 234 against him. A week ago down at Stetson, He threw seven innings, gave up six hits, two earned runs, two walks, eight Ks en route to that victory last Friday night. Bryce, both these teams come in similar ways. Last weekend at home, Liberty was able to sweep FGCU to get themselves back in the mix at the top of the conference standings. Kennesaw swept Stetson a week ago, but then both had midweek hiccups against Power 5 competition.
Well, yeah, but you got to look at it. For Kennesaw State, at least, this is the best start they've had in program history, a 10-2 conference start. So a lot of things are cooking on both sides. It's though, you know, you get those big midweek games, and we'll talk about it a little bit more later, but that Tuesday night game, at least for Kennesaw, was almost 4.5 hours. I mean, it was a 7 o'clock start. Game didn't really end until 11:15, final 17-15 Georgia. But Kennesaw State had a lot to be proud of. Both teams had over 10 hits. I believe Georgia finished with 15 and Kennesaw finished with 14. So the Owls are going to be looking for a bounce-back game. Same thing here with Liberty, coming off a 10-6 loss against Virginia Tech. Both are very sour losses for both teams, and both have a lot to prove today.
They sure do. And starting that game for Virginia Tech against Liberty on Tuesday night was former Owl Ryan Kennedy, who threw three scoreless innings. We're ready to go. Meyer's first pitch, fastball right through there for a strike, and he gets ahead of Gray Betts. Betts enters today's action hitting .287 on the season. The 0-1. Ground ball to second base. Mims charges it, gets it on a short hop, flips it over to Cash for out number one. Nice play there by Hudson Mims to start the ball game.
And that's exactly how you're going to want with to start for Kennesaw State. Nice easy hopper over to Hudson Mims. Nothing too crazy, nothing, just kept it simple. Right over Donovan Cash, got the first out of the inning.
Next up will be the right fielder switch hitting Aaron Anderson, stepping into the left-handed batter's box against the right-handed Jack Myers. First pitch to him. Fastball right through there again for strike number one. So quickly ahead of both hitters here. And that's the name of the game for Myers. Getting ahead, throwing ground balls, and good things typically happen. The 0-1. That ball's fouled off out of play, and Myers is quickly ahead 0-2.
That's four pitches so far in this ball game. All four have been strikes. Good start here pitching-wise for Kennesaw State and Jack Myers.
Both these teams are driven a lot by their transfers, and we'll talk a little bit about that as the game goes. 0-2, downstairs at 89 miles an hour for ball number one.
Got a little bit of a caster's curse there. Just talk about the four straight strikes. Now he throws the ball. That's just how baseball goes.
Myers working out the full line, the pitch, breaking ball. This one tapped foul over by the Liberty Flames on deck circle and over the head of the Ace Suns leading home run king at this point, Derek Orndorff.
Just got a little bit over it, fouled it off backwards. Still a 1-2 count, so still a chance. Going to have to be very smart here at the plate.
1-2 pitch. Change up, swing and a miss. Strikeout for Jack Myers of Aaron Anderson. And that's out number two here in the top of the first inning. The Owls come out on Thursday night in their pinstripe uniforms, their typical Friday night attire. The Liberty Flames come out in the gray pants, blue tops with Liberty etched across the chest in white. Water Blues, a social media sensation, and tomorrow's starter, Dylan Cumming. 2-0 pitch is also downstairs. That'll extend it to 3-0. Saturday starter Dylan Cumming was the star of that social media explosion on the reveal of those powder blue uniforms. So we will wait and see if they display those and wear those one game this weekend. 3-0 forthcoming to Orndorff. Fastball right through there at 87 for strike one.
Don't want to pitch directly to him. You mentioned the home run king of the A-Sun right now. Don't want to give him anything that he has a chance to take all the way. Trying to pitch all around except his sweet spot.
Waves the bat over his head. The 3-1, swing and a miss. Another fastball in the outside corner. 87 miles an hour on that one. And Myers gets it to a 3-2 count. 3-2, two outs here, top of the first. No score from Kennesaw. And that one's fouled at the plate and off of Orndorff. And we'll do the 3-2 again. As we mentioned, these teams enter sitting atop the A-Sun East standings. Kennesaw at 10-2, Liberty at 7-5, These same two teams set atop the standings a year ago and played six games the final 2 weeks of the regular season, with Liberty taking 5 out of 6 to secure the regular season championship. 3-2, fouled off of Orndorff again and up the first baseline, and the left fielder, 3, Hillier, will pick it up and flip it into the dugout.
Orndorff trying to extend the inning here for his team, trying to just get a base knock against Jack Myers, who's doing a good job just pitching all around.
The wind and the 3-2 for Myers. Breaking ball. That one's going to miss outside, and that'll be ball four. So what you typically do not want to see is a two-out walk, but the Flames have one, and one of the conference's leading stolen base threats is now at first base. He not only leads the conference in home runs with 12, but he is at the top of the list in stolen bases as well, also with 12.
Well, Trey, something else to kind of look at, and KSU may be a little bit lucky to just let him off with a walk. Orndorff hit .462 so far this season with two outs, so definitely not what you want to have him on, but just to give up only a single base isn't the worst thing in the world.
That'll bring up another left-handed hitter, 3, Hillier, the left fielder. First pitch to him is a changeup, swung on and missed, and Myers jumps ahead again, 0-1.
Hillier batting .288 with runners on. As a runner on first, you mentioned a big stolen base threat on first in Orndorff. We'll see if he maybe goes two here with two outs.
Myers sets at the belt, checks Orndorff a couple times, and throws over, and Orndorff slides back in safely. Head first, getting the uniform dirty here early on Thursday night. Thursday, Friday, Saturday this weekend with the Easter holiday on Sunday. Most all baseball teams across the country will be playing Thursday, Friday, Saturday this week. Oh-1 coming to Hillier. There goes Orndorff. Hassan catches the throw down. One hop. The tag will not be in time. So nice job right there by Tyler Simon, the shortstop, catching that ball in the short hop and getting the tag down, but not before Derek Orndorff could get his right hand in there. And the Flames have a runner in scoring position with two outs in the top of the first. Orndorff takes his lead from second. The pitch from Myers is outside, and the count moves to 2-1. So had to think with two outs, head coach Scott Jackson would have Orndorff on the move, and he was, in his 13th stolen base of the year.
Still hasn't been caught once stealing as well, so been productive around the bases.
2-1 from Myers. Off speed, fouled over by the third base coach's box. Nice grab there by Liberty head coach Scott Jackson.
Yeah, it was a check swing there from Hillier. Didn't want to go all the way around, checked it about halfway. Fouled it off towards the KSU bench. Now counts now even at 2-2.
So big pitch on the way already early here in this one. Top of the first, no score. Orndorff on at second. He walked and stole second base. And Hillier waving the bat over his head. Lines that one into left center field. On comes Hatcher. He's not going to get there. That one's going to be down. And that will score the first run of the weekend. And the Liberty Flames jump on top 1-0.
Good start here for Liberty, doing a nice job just getting the bats going early. Two out. Situational hitting here is going to be big tonight. Liberty already doing a good job of it early.
That'll bring up the shortstop. Stephen Hill enters the game hitting .284 on the year. 9 doubles, 4 home runs. And as it sometimes seems to happen, the two-out walk comes home to roost for the Owls. First pitch to Hill. Is up in the zone with a fastball for ball number one. Crowd is still filing in here on a Thursday work day, but should have a good one before this game is over. 1-0 pitch for Myers. That ball's grounded into the hole and through into left field. Kalina comes in and gets it. And he will throw it to the cutoff man. But back-to-back singles have put a run on the board and have runners at first and second for the Flames in the top of the first inning with two outs.
Something interesting here. Kennesaw State 7-5 when the opponent scores first, so kind of used to being down so far this season. Liberty doing a good job of keeping the bats going with two outs. First game in Georgia for the Flames in 2022.
I'll bring up the first baseman, Logan Mathau. Matthew hitting .224 on the year, three home runs, led the A-Sun in home runs in 2021 with 15. And the first pitch to him is in there with a cutter for at 79 miles an hour, first strike number one. As I said, Matthew in led the A-Sun in home runs in 2021 with 15. Hit one of those against the Owls in the conference tournament a year ago. 0-1 pitch, changeup, rolled over to second. Mims has it. He flips to Simon is short, and that will end the top of the first inning, but not before the Flames score one run on two hits. They did so by way of an important two-out walk. We head to the bottom half. Flames on top, 1-0. Here on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Trey Fowler alongside Bryce Gobert. Let's set the starters defensively. This new look defense for the Liberty Flames that head coach Scott Jackson trots out. Talking to him before the game, he was not happy with the way they had played defense to this point. As we mentioned, they led the country in defense a year ago. Highest fielding percentage, least amount of errors per game. That hasn't been the case so far in 2022. So last weekend, he shook it up. It led to a weekend sweep of FGCU up in Liberty. In left field, number 3, Three Hillier. In center field, number 20, Derek Orndorff. In right field, number 9, Aaron Anderson. At third base, number 5, Georgia native Cameron Foster. At shortstop, number 17, Stephen Hill. At second base, number 22, Nathan Keeter. At first base, number 55, Logan Mathau. And behind the plate, number 2, Gray Betts. On the mound for the Flames will be number 14, the freshman Garrett Horn, who enters 3-1 on the year, 27 and a third innings pitch, 18 hits, 10 runs, only 5 of them earned, 10 walks, 47 strikeouts, opponents hitting 178 against him. Last weekend against FGCU, 5 and a third, 4 hits, 2 runs. 3 walks and 9 strikeouts in their 11-3 Friday night victory over the Eagles, who entered that series a week ago against the Flames in first place, dropped down to a tie for second after last weekend. Hatcher steps in for the Owls. First pitch to him is fouled off over by the Flames dugout, and quickly ahead is Garrett Horn, 0-1. Hatcher enters the ball game, hitting .426 on the year, 16 doubles, 3 triples, 4 home runs, 30 RBIs, a 26-game hitting streak, and he has reached base 30 games in a row.
Something to look out for here, Trey. That foul ball looks like it hit catcher Gray Betts in the foot, so we had a little bit of a delayed second pitch here.
0-1, that one's popped out of play down the left field line. Gray Betts, a very important player for this bunch. Head coach Scott Jackson talked about the leadership he gets from both the catcher, Gray Betts, and the right fielder, Aaron Anderson. 0-2. Breaking ball, swing and a miss, and that'll be strikeout number 1 on the night for Garrett Horn as he gets one of the nation's hottest hitters in Josh Hatcher.
Trey, I want to go back to something you said earlier on before we started this bottom half of the first. Last year, Liberty's fielding percentage was a .984 at the end of the season. So far this year, they have a .974. So not too bad still, but still can have some room to improve.
That'll bring up Tyler Simon, the shortstop. First pitch to him's lined into left field. That one's going to get into the corner. Simon rounds first, heads to second. Hillier picks it up and tosses it in. And Simon will have a one-out double. That is his eighth double on the year.
Trey, whenever you can, you strike out the hottest guy in your lineup, you got to rely on other parts of your lineup to get hitting going. And Tyler Simon does just that with a double only here, one out, bringing up a hot hitter. And Donovan Cash.
Donovan Cash steps to the plate, hitting 360. Sixth in the A-Sun in hitting. He moves up into the three hole in the vacated spot by the injury to Zach Corbin. First pitch to him is a breaking ball at 80 miles an hour. Right through there for strike number one. The right-handed hitters are going to have to step up big tonight for the Owls. This horn is very tough on the lefties. A 1-0 pitch is downstairs in the dirt with another breaking ball. Moves the count to 1-1. Left-handed hitters on the year hitting only 146 against Garrett Horn. Right-handed hitters not much better, only 200, but they do seem to have the advantage against the southpaw from Liberty. One-one, another breaking ball right through there for a strike at 80 miles an hour. Moves the count to 1-2. We're in the bottom of the first. Flames jumped on top in the top half, 1-0 on the strength of two hits and a two-out walk. Owls looking to answer here in the bottom half. 1-2 pitch, fastball fouled over the first base dugout and deep onto the old soccer field. Garrett Horn will run the fastball up there between 92 and 95 miles an hour. 62% of his strikeouts on the year are with the fastball. Be interesting to see if he sticks with it here again to Cash. He does not and misses downstairs with a breaking ball. Nice block right there by Gray Betts to keep Tyler Simon at second.
Just about to say, really nice job there. Tyler Simon, 7 out of 8. On stolen bases this year so far, so nice job to keep him at second. Cash hitting 375 with runners in scoring position here on the 2-2 count.
There goes Simon. The ground ball is hit to short. He's got it over to first is Hill to Matthew for the out. So Simon was running on the pitch, but he stays at third, and he'll be there with two outs for the third baseman, Cash Young.
Good guy to have in your cleanup spot, Cash Young, with 8 home runs on the year, 29 RBIs. See if he can get some production and tie this ball game up here in the bottom of the first for Kennesaw State.
Cash Young, after transferring from Georgia College, has had the knack for the big hit here for the Owls. First pitch to him's line back through the middle, and once again on cue, a single by Cash Young coming up big in a big spot with two outs to tie this game at one as Tyler Simon crosses home plate.
Cash Young now tied for first on this Kennesaw State Owls team in RBIs with Josh Hatcher at 30. Owls tie the game still with a runner on with two outs here in the bottom of the first.
Be interesting to see if the Owls try to run on the left-hander Garrett Horn. Both these teams ranked near the bottom of the conference. KSU 9th, Liberty 11th, and runners caught stealing. First pitch to him is a breaking ball downstairs. Nice pick right there by Gray Betts. And the count's 1-0. Now that stat can be deceiving because their runners caught stealing percentage puts them, KSU at 5th, Liberty at 7th. So they haven't had quite as many people run against them, and that's probably because of the veteran presence back there. The 1-0 pitch is downstairs, and that'll be 2-0 on Hudson Mims, the second baseman who enters this game's action, hitting 320 with two home runs and 14 RBIs. The veteran presence of Gray Betts and Nick Hassan usually deter teams from running a little bit. 2-0 also downstairs. And the count will be 3-0 on Hudson Mims. You mentioned it, Bryce. The Owls have a knack for answering back. They did it time and time again the other night against Georgia. Just couldn't get their head above water and get the lead. 3-0 pitch. Breaking ball right through there at 80 miles an hour. And it makes the count 3-1.
And another thing I kind of touched on earlier on in the top half of this ball game early on here was timely hitting. Both teams get two out hits that lead to runs. We'll see if that trend continues throughout.
3-1. Fastball downstairs, swung on and missed. That one came through at 92 miles an hour. So we got a 3-2 count, two outs. Matthew moves behind Cash Young at first base. Cash Young will be on the move with the pitch. And here it is. Swing and a miss, strike three. So the second strikeout of the inning for Horn, but the Owls answer back with one run on two hits of their own. At the end of one, we are tied here in Kennesaw, 1-1.
The fans, our concession stand accepts all major cards as forms of payment. Make sure to stop by and enjoy your favorites such as hot dogs, popcorn, and ice cold Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola is the official beverage partner of Kennesaw State Athletics. Harden Realty Group is a real estate team made up of team leader Damian Harden and Ariana Guerrero of REMAX Regency. Specializing in the metro Atlanta area and North Atlanta, they are dedicated to helping you with all of your real estate needs. Please reach out to Dave at 770-401-0252. Hey, fans, make some noise and look out for that T-shirt. It's Tyler Simon. He's
back here on the KSU Owl Network. Owls and Flames tied at one, headed to the second inning. A lot riding on this one this weekend as we finish out the first time through in this A-Sun regular season schedule. The way it's set up, there are six teams in the East, six teams in the West. Each team plays everyone in their division, home and away, so a total of six times. This weekend closes out that first trip through the order. And the Owls are looking to maintain their first place standing. And the Flames are looking to wrestle it away heading into the second half of the regular season. Up first for the Flames in the second is going to be the third baseman, Cameron Foster. And he'll take a breaking ball just off the outside corner from Jack Myers. Cameron Foster, Georgia product. One-0 pitch. Another breaking ball. This one skips all the way to the backstop. 2-0. Cameron Foster, Georgia product. Played at Scouts Baseball post-grad program. And Scott Jackson and his staff were able to find him, and they've been pleasantly surprised with this young freshman. 2-0 pitch, fastball in the inside corner, but just misses a little down for ball number three. This is what happened to the Owls on Tuesday night, Bryce. They would get the game tied, get back in it a little bit, go out, walk the leadoff guy. They need to avoid that. 3-0 pitch, that one's going to be a strike called by home plate umpire Eric Gauthier.
That was a little bit low in there. Still called strike number one. Fans aren't happy with it. Third base coach Scott Strickland isn't either. Umpire telling him.
3-1 pitch. Fastball in the outside corner for strike number two. And Gauthier was telling head coach Scott Jackson that that ball was not low. And everyone's entitled to their own opinion. 3-2 pitch. Fouled off at the plate and off Hassan. We'll do the 3-2 one more time. Gauthier's joined in the umpire crew today at first base, Stephen Hagan. And at third base, Brian Hill. We'll see these three guys all weekend as they rotate around, and each guy takes a game behind the plate.
KSU back to the three-man umpiring crew, unlike Georgia where they had four, so back to what they normally have.
3-2 pitch. Lined up the middle, diving stop by Mims. He makes the throw to first, and he is out at first base. So wonderful play there by Hudson Mims off of Jack Myers. Score that one 1-6-3 if you're scoring at home, as it caught a piece of Myers on the way by, who slowed it down just enough for Mims to be able to dive, make the catch, and scramble to his feet for the throw to first base.
What a great play there from Hudson Mims. It's tough enough to make a diving catch when it doesn't deflect off of anything.
First pitch to Gulikowski is right through there for a strike, 0-1.
It's a tough play just to make a diving catch when it doesn't deflect off anything, but after it hits off your pitcher and changes directions a little bit, Mims had to adjust while pretty much already deciding he was going to dive. Still got the play, made the out.
0-1 to Gulikowski is a changeup, catches the top of the zone for a strike, moves the count to 0-2. Gulikowski was an owl killer in 2021, 9-for-24 a year ago with 3 home runs and 8 RBIs. 0-2 pitch, and that's a breaking ball fouled off of Gulikowski, and the count remain 0-2, and he's a big reason why this Flames team won 5 out of 6 in the regular season and 6 out of 7 on the year, counting the conference tournament victory with those 8 big RBIs. He was second team all-conference a year ago at DH. 0-2 pitch, outside this time, 1-2. And he was a member of the all-regional team in Knoxville as the Flames went in that large bid and headed to Tennessee, in which they had a very fine showing in the Tennessee regional a year ago before Tennessee headed to Omaha. 1-2 pitch, change up, hit a mile down the right field line, but way out of play. So you see some of the power that Gulikowski has. 8 home runs in 2021. Big reason why he was second team all conference.
4 this year with 28 RBIs, so just continues to show.
1-2 pitch, breaking ball, rolled over to first baseman Donovan Cash. He's got it. He'll take him himself and step on the bag for out number 2 here in the top of the first inning. So good job by Myers there, getting a guy who's had big time success against the boys in black and gold. That'll bring up the ninth place hitter, number 22, second baseman Nathan Keeter. Keeter identified as Coach Scott Jackson as the biggest surprise for this Liberty Flames bunch. First pitch from Myers is downstairs for a ball, 1-0. Keeter's played the outfield, he's played the infield this year. Called him a Swiss Army knife. 1-0 pitch is upstairs this time, 2-0. Are continuing to file in here on this Thursday evening ball game. 2-0 pitch. That one's downstairs for a ball. Now 3-0. So Myers is in danger of another 2-out walk that came back to haunt him in the first inning after he walked Orndorff, who promptly stole second and scored on the 3 Hillier single to center field. 3-0 right through there for a strike. Makes the count 3-1. Top of the second, tied at 1, 2 outs for the Flames. 3-1 pitch. That one's right through there again. A little bit of a hesitation from home plate umpire Eric Gaucher before making that call. But that'll run the count full on the second baseman, Nathan Keeter. 3-2 pitch. Strike 3 at the top of the zone. And that'll be out number 3 for the Flames here in the top of the second inning. We'll head to the bottom half. Game still tied at 1 here on the KSU Owl Network.
Tonight's clue is baseball slang.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Trey Fowler joined in the booth alongside by Bryce Gobert. The Owls and Flames knotted at one apiece.
Trey, real quick, as we were in break, and I'm sure if you were saw watching at home, as Flames were heading off the field, head coach Scott Jackson had a couple words for the home plate umpire. They had a little bit of a chat and parted their ways, so we'll see if that kind of continues throughout this game.
You think he was asking him what his Easter plans were?
You know, I don't think that was quite the topic of conversation, but you never know.
There might be an Easter egg reference before this game's over in reference to his strike zone if it continues. Leading off the bottom of the second for the Owls is going to be catcher Nick Hassan. Hassan enters the game hitting 247. First pitch to him. Breaking ball in there for strike one. So early in this game, Garrett Horn is doing a good job landing that breaking ball early in the count. Hassan fixing the Evo shield on his left elbow. The pitch to him is grounded over to second base. Keeter's got it. He'll throw over to Matthew at first for out number one. Keeter positioned perfectly right there, cheating the right-handed hitting Hassan up the middle and preventing that ball from sneaking through into center field.
Second time in this ball game that the leadoff hitter for Kennesaw State has been retired.
That'll bring up the right fielder, number 21, Braden Edson. First pitch to him is upstairs and out of the zone at 93 miles an hour on that fastball from Garrett Horn. Garrett Horn, just a freshman. This Liberty staff is super excited about the future of this young man. 1-0 pitch. Fastball lofted into center field. On comes Orndorff, and he will make the catch, moving to his right for out number two. Flames super excited about the future of lefty Garrett Horn. Talking to Scott Jackson this morning, they wanted to try and protect him a little bit early in the year. They knew he would eventually find his way into the rotation, but they did not want to put that stress on him early in his freshman year. They decided to wait a little bit. He earned this opportunity, and he gets Spencer Hansen to ground another one to Keeter, who flips over to Matthew at first, and that'll be out number three in the bottom half of the second inning. So both teams go scoreless in the second. We'll head to the third, still tied at one here on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. We want to welcome everyone joining in on YouTube this evening. Keep it clean in the chat. I have a little trivia for you later on this evening. But we appreciate everyone joining in. Tanner Franklin saying hootie hoo. Tom Miles saying go Owls. We've got Scott saying go Flames. And Daniel Moulet saying go Flames as well. So it looks evenly distributed between Flames and Owl fans. And that's great to see. We got two great ball clubs in what proves to be a very great weekend of baseball. First pitch to Gray Betts is outside for ball number one on a changeup from Jack Myers. Betts grounded out to second to open the game. First team all-conference in 2021. The 1-0 pitch is a swing and a miss on another changeup downstairs. And that makes the count 1-1. First team all-conference in 2021. Member of the all-regional team in Knoxville. The all-tourney team in the A-Sun Conference as well. Led the A-Sun in triples in 2021. Had a 21-game hit streak a year ago. 0-1 is grounded over to Hudson Mims at second again. Another nice play on a short hop. Throwing across his body back to Donovan Cash. And that will be out number one here in the third inning. That play very similar to the first one he made, Bryce.
Yeah, not to mention, real quick, you were listing all of Gray Betts' accolades this year, named the 2022 Posey Watch List as well. So a lot of success coming from behind the plate for the Flames and Gray Betts. But Hudson Mims making his third great play of the game to get the first out of the top of the third.
First pitch to Anderson stepping in is a ball high and outside. Gray Betts was a travel ball teammate of former Owl Ryan Kennedy on the Evo Shield Canes. Played some games here in Stillwell Stadium in high school. Anderson lines that one into right center field for a base hit. Hatcher comes over, cuts it off, and he'll hustle it back in and hold Anderson to a single at first base.
Nice job there from Aaron Anderson to get on base. Give Derek Orndorff, who hottest batter on this Flames offense, chance to drive in a run here with a good shot into the outfield.
Orndorff walked and scored after stealing a base in his first at bat, the Seton Hill transfer by way of Penn State, where he spent 2 years. Now a grad transfer here for Liberty. The first pitch to him is a fastball upstairs and out of the zone, but a swing and a miss by Orndorff. And Myers jumps ahead 0-1. Last year at Seton Hill, hit 353 with 15 home runs. Talking to Scott Jackson this morning, said he found out about Orndorff through a text from a former player he had coached at North Carolina. The 0-1 pitch from Myers. That's a breaking ball hit high into the infield. Cash Young comes in, settles under it. He'll make the catch for a very big out number two right there. But got a text from a former player, said, hey, you need to take a look at this guy. Scott Jackson went to Synergy, which is a video app a lot of teams use for scouting reports and scouting and the like, and was able to evaluate the video on Orndorff, and what do you know it, he's a Flame, and he's leading the conference in home runs. They'll bring up three Hillier with two outs and Anderson on first base. First pitch to him is off speed, downstairs in the dirt. Nice stop by Nick Hassan. You mentioned the Posey watch list. Both of these catchers, two of the nation's finest, Nick Hassan and Gray Betts, on display here in Kennesaw, Georgia this weekend. Myers checks a couple of times, the 1-0. That one's up and outside for a ball, 2-0. Hillier had a single and an RBI his first at bat. He's responsible for the lone Flames run on the scoreboard right now. In a 1-1 ball game here in the third with two outs. Anderson has not attempted a stolen base on the year. The 2-0 pitch is outside, moves the count to 3-0. With grad transfer shortstop Stephen Hill waiting on deck for the Flames.
Something to look out for here, Trey. We saw Jack Myers just a second ago clearing off his landing area at the bottom of the mound. See if that has any effect going forward.
Myers sets in the 3-0. That one also upstairs and out of the zone, and that'll be ball four. Another two-out walk here. His second of the game. The first one came back to bite him. We'll see if this one has the same effect as Stephen Hill, the Moorhead State transfer, steps into the box for the Flames. And prepping for opening weekend this year, talked to the Moorhead State head coach, Coach Aoki, and he talked about the loss of Stephen Hill at that time being such a tremendous loss for his Moorhead State team because Stephen Hill was such a great leader. And Scott Jackson echoed those sentiments and talked about how great of a grinder he was. First pitch to him is a breaking ball, 80 miles an hour for strike number one. So Myers quickly jumps ahead of Hill here. Hill recently moving from third base, his normal position he's played most of his college career, to shortstop to help the Flames out there. 0-1 pitch, brushes Hill back and just misses him and evens the count at 1-1.
Still two outs here, so the Owls have a chance with a play at any base right now to get the third out and get out of this inning and get back to hitting.
Myers checks Anderson at second and delivers the 1-1. Another breaking ball. This one also catches the top of the zone for strike number two. Not where you want to live, but sometimes can be effective up there. 1-1, 2 strikes, 2 outs, 1-1 ball game here at Stillwell Stadium in the top of the third. Myers sets, gives Anderson a look back, once, twice, and delivers this breaking ball through the zone. Check swing by Hill, but he did not go, says first base umpire Stephen Hagen. So we'll have an evened up count at 2-2. Twos across the board here in the top of the third. Anderson at second, he singled. Hillier at first, he walked. 2-2 pitch. That one upstairs, and that one catches him in the head. Hill is down, and the trainer will make his jog out. And this so that one just got away from Myers.
Yeah, and luckily he was able to get his head turned, so it hit him in the back of the helmet, which is still not good. But it didn't go straight off the front of the face.
While the trainers attend to Hill, we're going to step out for a second here on the KSU Owl Network. We'll be right back in a few moments. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Stephen Hill is up and making his way to first base. That's a great sign to see out of him. That can be very scary for you Flames fans, as a few weeks back, Derek Orndorff was hit in the head, actually in the C-flap that comes across his face. And he had to miss the rest of that weekend against Stetson. Does not appear to be as serious here for Hill, which is a great sign to see and a great thing to see for the Flames and Stephen Hill himself. Described by Scott Jackson as the definition of toughness, and he's showing that right here after the 2-2 pitch got away from Myers and caught him on the back of the helmet. And the trainer checks him out and gives him the okay. And Stephen Hill's going to stay in this ball game. So right on cue, Scott Jackson talked about how tough he is, and he's showing it right there, Bryce.
Yeah, and it's always good to see him being able to stay in the game. It's a hard hit to take right off the back of the head. I mean, you mentioned it. Orndorff had to miss the weekend series just a few weeks ago because it hit that little C plate you're talking about. Comes off to protect the face. Still checking on him. Umpire behind the plate says, good to go, but a good sign to see him up and standing on his own power. We still have time being called and checking him out. Taking just as much time as necessary here just to make sure. Coaches going to meet here.
And the umpire, Stephen Hagen, was giving his own look-see over to Stephen Hill, and now he's going to take a jog over and talk to head coach Scott Jackson. And I commend the umpires for what they're doing right here. Their job is to make sure that all players are in a safe environment and are safe at all times. And I think that's what we're seeing here from Stephen Hagen. Just wants to double check, make sure Hill's okay, and make sure Coach Jackson knows exactly what's going on.
And as Hill was standing over there on first, and it looks like Hill will come out of this game for a pinch runner. The first base umpire and Stephen Hagen was talking to him that whole entire time, just trying to make sure that he was okay. And just for safety, they'll take him out of this game for now.
And I, once again, commend the work there by Stephen Hagen. And now we're going to have a pinch runner coming in for Stephen Hill. It's going to be number 26, Adrian McNeil. Another freshman out of Lithonia, Georgia, in Redan High School.
Pitch running for the Flames is number 26, Adrian McNeil.
So reset the stage for you here. We're in the top of the third inning in a 1-1 ball game. Flames scored their run in the top of the first inning on an RBI single with two outs by Three Hillier. The Owls answered on an RBI two-out single of their own by third baseman Cash Young. We now have the bases loaded with two outs here in the top of the third. All of this damage, Anderson singled one out. Orndorff popped out to third base, and then a walk to Hillier in the hit-by-pitch there by Stephen Hill has loaded the bases for Logan Matthew, the first baseman. Entered the game today hitting .224 with three home runs. Had a big game the other night against Virginia Tech in which he had three hits. And Scott Jackson had hoped that that was the game that would get Logan Matthew going. The 2021 Ace Sun home run champion with 15 a year ago. First pitch to him. Change up downstairs. Good block by Nick Hassan to keep that one in front of him and keep the Flames off the scoreboard.
Matthew batting .500 with bases loaded this season so far. Took the first pitch. Looked like he wanted to swing. Saw it was going to be an off-speed pitch and held off.
The 1-0 pitch, breaking ball, catches the outside corner for a strike, 1-1. Matthew, a very good right-handed breaking ball hitter. That ball breaks into his swing a little bit, so if Jack Myers is going to throw that pitch, he's going to need to keep it right where he just threw it and backdoor it on the outside corner. 1-1 pitch, fastball, chopped over to first base. Cash has it. He'll step on the bag, and that will end the inning for the Flames. So they load the bases, but do not score. We head to the bottom of the third here on the KSU Owl Network. Game still tied, 1-1.
Your Owls are back here at Stillwell Stadium tomorrow, Friday, April 15th at 5 p.m. against Liberty University. For more information and to purchase your tickets, call the box office at 470-578-4965 or visit www.ksuowls.com/tickets. Also, then visit the university stores for all of your spirit wear, textbooks, and technology needs at www.bookstore.ksu.edu.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Trey Fowler joined alongside Bryce Gobert. And before we get to this day in Owl history, Stephen Hill has re-entered the ballgame. Now, many of you might wonder, how exactly did that happen? Well, a couple of years back, the NCAA instituted a rule that said a player could exit the game if a concussion was thought to have taken place, to be checked out fully and thoroughly, and then if deemed okay by the training staff, re-enter the game. And I think that's what Stephen Hagen was talking to head coach Scott Jackson about, was telling him, hey, you can let him come out here, get fully evaluated, fully checked, and if he's good, put him back in the game, which they have done as he takes his place back at shortstop. So great to see Stephen Hill back in the game, and great to see a rule that hasn't come up much since its institution fully utilized. I commend Stephen Hagen on a great job there of umpiring. That'll bring up Nick Kalina for his first at bat of the day. First pitch to him is a fastball at 94 miles an hour, right through there on the outside corner for a strike. Kalina hitting .247 on the year, two homers, 13 RBIs. 0-1, another breaking ball in there for a strike. Moves the count to 0-2. Nick Kalina's kind of been the unsung hero here for Josh Hatcher and all that he's been able to do, getting on base a lot in front of Hatcher over the course of this 26-game hit streak and 30-game reach base streak as Kalina moved down to the nine hole during that Jacksonville series in which he had a walk, in which he had a game-winning home run. But he's reaching base at a 40% clip. One two's downstairs in the dirt for a ball. Two and two. He's reaching base at a 41% clip. 417 on base percentage despite the 247 average. So it shows you he's walking a lot, finding a way, scrapping out at bats, getting on base. The 2-2 is just off the outside corner at 92 miles an hour and runs the count full like it many times does with Nick Kalina in the box at 3-2.
Tied for first with walks on this team with Cash Young with 17. Has a chance now to take the lead with 18 if he walks here.
3-2 pitch. Breaking ball. Swing and a miss. Four strike three. Really good pitch right there by Garrett Horn to get the first out of the third inning. Showing a lot of confidence in his breaking ball there to execute it with a 3-2 count, knowing that Josh Hatcher waited on deck. And that brings up the aforementioned Josh Hatcher. First pitch to him. Fastball up in the zone, but he fouls it back to the screen. And Horn jumps ahead of him again, 0-1. Fans are still filing in here on the Thursday night game. 0-1 pitch is another fastball up and out of the zone, but fouled off by Josh Hatcher, and Horn is quickly ahead of him, 0-2.
Hatcher struck out his first time by.
And with two strikes, the Flames will move a little bit deeper into that pull shift. They're playing on Josh Hatcher with Cameron Foster playing natural shortstop. And that one's going to hit him. And that one gets him up around the pectoral area. And he's hurting a little bit as he makes his way down to first base. That fastball came in at 93 miles an hour. And that one can't feel good if you're Josh Hatcher. So he extends his own base streak to 31 games the hard way. And they're going to check him out here as he takes his time down the first base line. One-to-one ball game here, bottom of the third inning. One-to-one ball game, bottom of the third. Owls scored their run on an RBI single with two outs in the bottom of the first by Cash Young. After the Flames had scored a run in the top of the first on a two-out RBI single by Three Hillier. A couple of delays the last inning after the hit-by-pitch to Stephen Hill and now the hit-by-pitch to Owls' Josh Hatcher. That'll bring up the shortstop, number two, Tyler Simon, who got the offense going here for the Owls this evening with a double with two outs in the first inning. And for those of you watching on YouTube, we're having a little technical difficulty with the camera as it seems to be going in and out, so I'll try to paint the picture the best I can for you. Hatcher takes his lead from first. Horn sets and delivers a breaking ball in the dirt. And once again, a nice job of blocking the baseball by Gray Betts. Gray Betts, one of the best catchers in the A-Sun, one of the top catchers around the country. Top catching on display here in this series with Nick Hassan and Gray Betts. 0-1 pitch, that one in the dirt. Betts blocks that one, picks it up. Hatcher on his way to second. He's going to slide in there safely. So a great job by Josh Hatcher reading the dirt ball and getting into scoring position with one out for Tyler Simon. The count moves to 2-0 on Simon. Those are the little things that this Owl team, base running wise, have done so well in the 2022 season and a big reason why they find themselves atop of the A-Sun East standings and 13th in the country in RPI. 2-0 pitch from Horn. Fastball down right through there at the bottom of the zone. 92 miles an hour and a strike to Simon. Two balls, one strike, one out. Owls looking to jump on top for the first time this week. They fell down early on Tuesday night to Georgia, giving up five in the first, and could never get the lead in that ballgame. 2-1 off speed, downstairs in the dirt again, and Betts blocks another one to keep Hatcher at second base, but that moves the count to 3-1.
You know, Trey, you talked about it earlier with Nick Kalina being a good guy with Josh Hatcher being getting on base. You also got to talk about Tyler Simon, who's been good whenever Hatcher does get on base, getting him around to score a lot of runs here for this Owl offense. So,
the fifth-year senior, Tyler Simon, is putting together one of his best offensive seasons in an Owl uniform, and definitely his best since his freshman year when he was named a freshman All-American. 3-1, another breaking ball. That one downstairs, and that'll be a walk for Tyler Simon. So we've seen here early on, out of Garrett Horn, and the freshman has been as advertised so far for the Flames. Seems like he really, really likes that breaking ball in big spots. The freshman out of Kernersville High School, or Kernersville, North Carolina, and Glenn High School, doing a great job so far. High school swimmer is Garrett Horn. Uncle played professionally in the Rangers organization, so it's definitely in his bloodlines to be a quality arm, and the Flames are excited about the big things ahead in his future.
Owls with a good chance here. Sorry to cut you off, Trey. Owls with a good chance here to take the lead. Hatcher in scoring position. Simon on first. Donovan Cash done good job producing this year. 10 doubles on the year, one home run, 23 RBIs. One of the better guys to have at the plate in this situation.
Those 10 doubles for Cash rank him 10th in the Atlantic Sun. The mound visit by pitching coach Matt Williams is over, and we're back to baseball here. Hatcher bouncing around out at second base. The pitch is lined into center field, but right at Orndorff. He catches it. Hatcher's going to tag. The throw coming to third base. He slides in head first and will be safe there. And that'll put runners on the corners with two outs for the third baseman, Cash Young. So nice job of base running right there by Josh Hatcher. He saw Orndorff was going to have to catch that one flat-footed because it was a line drive right at him. Very hard to get very much on the throw when that happens. And Hatcher's able to get to third base. A little bit of a gamble there. And we'll see if head coach Ryan Coe puts Tyler Simon in motion. First pitch to Cash Young's a breaking ball. That one's grounded back through the middle off the hand of Horn to Keeter, who'll step on second for the force out and end the inning. So both teams threaten in the third, but do not score. We'll head to the fourth. Game still tied here at 1 on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Trey Fowler joined alongside Bryce Gobert. We're going to give you a little bit of this day in Owl history. On April 14th, 2007, the Owls defeated North Florida 4-2 here at Stillwell Stadium. Left fielder Jay Morrow and center fielder Martin Baker paced the offense as Morrow went 2-for-4 and Baker went 1-for-3 with two RBIs. On the mound, former Owl great and first-round pick of the Reds, Kyle Heckathorn, started and went six innings, allowing two runs on six hits with six strikeouts before turning it over to Bubba Blalock, who earned the win with three shutout innings in relief. That's this day in Owl history. And speaking of turning it over, I'm going to turn it over for the next four innings to my partner, Bryce Gobert.
Well, thank you, Trey. And we'll start it off here with third baseman Cameron Foster at the plate. Fouls off the first pitch for an early 0-1 count to Jack Myers. First time up. Grounded out to Hudson Mims, who made a nice diving play after the ball deflected off pitcher for the Owls, Myers. 0-1 pitch on its way. Crosses the plate. A little bit too high. 1-1 now. Here in the top of the fourth, Owls and Flames tied at one.
Foster started at second base early in the year for the Flames, has moved over to third.
1-1 pitch. That one's way outside. Cal moved to 2-1.
Moved over to third. Scott Jackson thinks that he has found a home over there. He feels much more comfortable at third base than he did at second.
2-1 pitch on its way. That one's fouled off. Back off Nick Hassan and back into play. Play will be blown dead, 2-2. Myers looking to get his third strikeout on the day. Struck out Aaron Anderson his first time up. And Nathan Keeter here with the 2-2 pitch. That one's going to be taken into right field, heading foul and into the Liberty bullpen. Nobody up there, so that ball will just hang out for a little bit. Still a 2-2 count. Struck out Nathan Keeter back in the bottom of the second. And part of a 1-2-3 inning for Kennesaw State. Count still 2-2 here with no outs in the top of the fourth. Foster will step back into the left side batter's box. Righty versus righty here on the 2-2 count. That one's going to be chopped towards third. Cash Young over to the play. Grabs it. Bouncer off the glove of Donovan Cash at first. Cameron Foster will stay safe. And the Flames get their leadoff man on. Brady Gulikowski will step into the batter's box to face off against Jack Myers. First time grounded out to Donovan Cash at first for the second out back in the top of the second inning. Runner on here with no outs. First pitch will be taken high into right field. Going back at the wall is Edson, and he will watch that one go. A two-run shot for the Liberty Flames and Brady Gulikowski. And when the two cross the plate, the Flames will have a 3-1 lead.
Mentioned it in his last at bat, Gulikowski has been an Owl killer over the last two seasons, that being his fourth home run, doing a nice job staying back on a changeup and hitting it deep over the right field fence.
Over there in right field towards the Waffle House. Gives Flames the 3-1 lead as Nathan Keeter struck out his first time up at the plate, showed bunt. Called for strike one. 0-1 the count here as the Flames just take the 3-1 lead. Second pitch to Keeter, misses on the outside. Back to a 1-1 count.
We talked at the very beginning of the game, Bryce, that defense could play a big role. Inning started with the error.
That one's going to be taken into left field. Kalina will scoop that one up, throw it in to the cutoff man and Tyler Simon. And still with no outs, the Flames have their third hit of the inning. Second hit of the inning. Flames looking to extend their lead here with no outs in the top of the fourth. take a 3-1 lead, courtesy of a Brady Goligowski two-run home run. Keeter still hanging in there as that one misses outside. Myers checks first. Soaking over, going to throw back. Cash doesn't do the motion to go for the tag. We'll just catch it and throw it back to Jack Myers on the bump.
If you're head coach Scott Jackson, a lot of things you could do here. You could bunt with Gray Betts, who is a very good bunter. You could hit and run as he handles the bat very well as well.
1-0 pitch. We'll turn over to 2-0 as he showed bump, pulled it back. Myers missed upstairs and away. His first two times up, grounded out to Hudson Mims as we're going to have a mound visit here for Kennesaw State. Trey, as a former coach, what are you going to be telling Jack Myers here?
The big thing you've got to do right here is you've got to stay in the moment. You've given up the lead. It's 3-1, but you've got to continue battling. You know that your offense is one that is adept at coming back. 7-5 on the year when being down. That's something in their DNA. They come back time and time and time again. The key is keeping it close. And for the Owls, in the games that they've been able to limit the crooked innings, those are the games they've had the most success coming back. That's the message that Coach Pastor is trying to get across to Jack here and get him back in the dugout, let his offense go back to work.
Back to a 2-0 count. Runner on in Keeter. 2-0 pitch. Bunted, go foul. Count moves to 2-1.
That was a bunt for a base hit attempt right there by Gray Betts. He saw that Cash Young had not respected the first time he squared around, so he was going to try and lay it down. Cash Young goes even further back here with only one strike, and many times as a coach, you try to go right back to the guy that made the error to see if he can make the next play.
2-1 count here, no outs, top of the fourth. Throw back to first to Cash, still not troubling Nathan Keeter. 2-1 count, top of the fourth. Flames tack on two so far. Have the lead 3-1 over the Kennesaw State Owls here on this beautiful Thursday night in Kennesaw. 2-1 pitch, misses outside as we now see some action in the Kennesaw State bullpen. Players going over there. Nobody up and pitching yet. 3-1 now the count. Flames with five hits so far. Betts trying to add on to that count. 3-1 pitch on the way. Watches that one in. For strike number two, catches the outside corner on the off speed.
And that's a job of Gray Betts taking all the way right there. This Gray might be one of the best hitters in all of the Atlantic Sun Conference, maybe in all the country, at hitting with two strikes. He has no fear of doing that. So he has the luxury of being able to take that pitch.
Full count here, nobody out. Runner on first. 3-2 pitch on the way. Runner goes. That one's going to be chopped over towards Hudson Mims. He'll throw to Donovan Cash and retire the first batter of the inning.
Third consecutive ground out to Mims for Gray Betts.
Third time it's also been the first out of the inning. As Aaron Anderson, who singled his last time up, 1-for-2 so far on the day. Left on base at the plate. Lefty versus righty matchup. One away here in the top of the fourth. First pitch off speed. Misses outside 1-0. Good crowd here at Stillwell Stadium for a matchup in the A Sun between the Flames and the Owls. Flames on top currently 3-1. Take the lead in the earlier part of this top of the fourth. That pitch from Myers gets away from him and misses upstairs. Count moves to 2-0.
The difference here for Myers here in this fourth inning as opposed to the first three, his secondary pitches, the breaking ball and the changeup are staying up. Gulikowski took advantage of an up changeup for the two-run home run. The two breaking balls here to Anderson from the first and second pitch have both been up, and he falls behind 2-0.
Myers checks back to second. We'll throw the 2-0. Again, misses upstairs a little bit outside as well. 3-0 now the count. Keeter standing on second. Simon there watching him. Myers still on the bump here for the Owls. 3-0 count with one out. Checking back at second. Looks at Keeter. Looks back at the plate. We'll throw to Anderson. Fastball gets in there for strike number one. Count now at 3-1.
Anderson had 25 multi-hit games in 2021, which led to him being an A-Sun all-first-team member and a first-team All-American.
Batting 315 on the year, 273 with runners in scoring position. We'll take that one to Hudson Mims. Nice play by him on the backhand. Throws over to Donovan Cash for the second out of the inning for the Owls. Keeter will move to third and now in better scoring position for Derek Orndorff. Walked his first time up, stole a base, ended up coming around to score. Fly out in the infield over to Cash Young his second time. Runner in scoring position.
We mentioned it a little bit the last inning that Orndorff was hit in the head a few weeks ago as they played Stetson on Friday night. Caused him to miss a couple of games.
Up at the plate here with a chance to extend the lead for the Flames. First pitch is low in the dirt.
When Orndorff went out of the lineup, Gray Betts was already out of the lineup, so you have two of your top three hitters out of the lineup, and that led to Liberty actually losing the first two series back-to-back that they have since joining the A-Sun.
1-0 pitch on the way. That one going to be fouled up over the press box and into the street. Count to now on a 1-1.
They dropped 2 of 3 with both of those guys out of the lineup to Stetson, then went down the next weekend to Jacksonville and dropped 2 of 3 as both came back in the lineup.
Myers now with the 1-1 pitch on the way to Orndorff. Again, misses low, now 2-1.
Action in the Owl bullpen is going to be left-handed freshman Miller Riggins.
Have a great one. 2-1 still the count here with two outs. Top of the fourth, Flames on top, 3-1. 2-1 pitch on its way, and that one's going to be driven into right field again. Going back at the wall, and that one's gone. Edson just has to watch two go over his head in this inning, both for two-run shots. The Flames make a 3-1 lead, now a 5-1 lead here in the top of the fourth.
Orndorff showed why he leads the A-Sun in home runs right there. His 13th of the year puts the Flames on top 5-1, and he's a strong, strong young man. Hit 15 home runs last year at Seton Hill, his 13th already for the Flames, and he can go out to any part of the ballpark. A lot of his home runs this year in a very spacious Liberty ballpark to dead center field.
Came into this game batting 462 with two outs as Hillier will drive that one into right field, but it will be in foul territory, 0-1. Came into the game hitting 462 with two outs. Took that one deep into right field to extend this Liberty lead to 5 as they put up a 4 spot here in the top of the fourth. 0-1 pitch to Hillier. That one misses outside on a fastball. 1-1 now the count.
For those of you joining us on YouTube, please bear with us a little bit. We've got a loose cable that's causing a little bit of that going in and out with the camera. We're doing the best we can to try and get that problem addressed.
1-1 pitch is going to be driven to Josh Hatcher, high and center field. He'll catch that one, and the Owls will get out of the inning. Not before the Flames do some damage. They take the lead 5-1. Here on the KSU Owl Network. Welcome back here to Stillwell Stadium. Owls now trail the Liberty Flames here in game one of this three-day weekend series. 5-1, Flames with 2-2 run home runs in the top of the fourth. One courtesy of Derek Orndorff, the other Brady Goligowski. Owls now with some work to do as we head to the bottom of the fourth. Trey, former coach yourself, you go down 5-1 after having a pretty good offensive start. How do you come back from that, and what do you tell your guys in the dugout?
You don't have to tell this bunch very much. They've had to come back a lot this year. They're very accustomed to it. You just tell them to keep playing. There's a lot of ball game left.
First pitch misses upstairs and away, 1-0. Hudson Mims at the plate here for Kennesaw State. Struck out his first time by. 1-0 pitch this time. Will miss also high. 2-0 now you're counting here. No outs. Bottom of the fourth. Flames lead the Owls by 4. Two-oh pitch to Mims. That one crosses the plate. Fastball right down the middle. 2-1. Horn starting to battle back. Mims looking to be a leadoff runner here for Kennesaw State. 2-1 pitch on the way. That one's going to be hit to the shortstop, and Stephen Hill, good to see him back in the game. He'll make the throw over to Logan Matthew in time, and the Flames get their first out.
As we mentioned with Stephen Hill, shortstop is relatively new to him, at least as a college player. He played a lot of third base at Morehead State. He had played third base all year for the Flames until the recent switch to shortstop because of some of the defensive woes the Flames have had in 2022 to this point.
Hassan now standing in. Takes that one, a high bouncer in the infield. Throw to first will be in time. Nice play there from Gray Betts to track that one on the high bounce and make the throw over to Matthew.
That is a great play right there by Gray Betts. A great job of avoiding contact with pitcher Garrett Horn. If Garrett Horn, the left-handed pitcher, fields that ball, he's going to have to turn all the way around. I can't tell you how many times in my coaching career I've seen that throw from a left-hander end up in the right field corner. So Gray Betts, good job to secure that. Much easier throw for him.
Two outs here. Brayden Edson step into the batter's box. Lefty versus lefty matchup. First pitch to him, 1-0 now. Second one misses.
And as each inning passes by for the Owls, the task becomes tougher. Liberty's one of the best teams in the country the last several years at holding a lead once they get it late in a game.
2-0 pitch. Misses inside this time. Edson just stepped back a little bit.
One of the top bullpens in the A-Sun and actually in the country with Mason Fluardi and Cade Hungate down there waiting in the back end.
3-0 now the count. As Edson just watches that one go by on the 3-0 count, now 3-1 here with two outs in the bottom part of the fourth. Flames on top, 5-1. 3-1 pitch on the way. Edson watches that one. He threw his bat. Thought that one was low and away. Umpire says catches the bottom left corner of the strike zone, gets in there for strike two.
Home plate umpire Eric Gaucher has called some low pitches in this game, just hasn't been very consistent with it.
3-2 pitch on the way now to Edson. That one inside, definitely ball number four. And the Owls have one runner on with two outs. Spencer Hansen, designated hitter for today's game. Grounded out to second, his first time up. Came in today batting 254. 364 with two outs and 310 with runners on. First pitch misses low, 1-0.
Once again, I want to thank everyone joining in on YouTube. And please bear with us. We think we have the problem solved a little bit. So hopefully no more hiccups the rest of the way.
1-0 pitch, off speed. Slider gets in there. Count now even at one apiece here. Two outs, bottom of the fourth. Owls with a runner on first and Braden Edson. They trail the Flames 4-4. Swing and a miss by Hansen at the plate. Makes the count now 1-2. Garrett Horn doing a nice job battling back after going down early.
He hasn't missed a beat. Fastball still coming in the low 90s, 92, 93 miles an hour.
Takes that one swinging high, and he misses it. 1-2 goes to strike number three, and the side is retired by Garrett Horn. Owls will head to the top of the fifth, playing some defense. They still trail the Flames by 4 here on the KSU Owl Network. Welcome back here to Stillwell Stadium. The Liberty Flames make the trip up to Kennesaw and currently hold a 4-run, 5-1 lead. New pitcher in here for Kennesaw State will be Miller Riggins. Trey, what's the rundown on him?
Freshman Miller Riggins out of Houston County High School in Tennessee. He'll come in here. He pitched on Tuesday night against the University of Georgia. 1 2/3, 2 hits, 1 run. It was earned with 1 strikeout, one of the better outings of the night on Tuesday, and I think that's a big reason why you see him in here. The Owls had to use a lot of bullets in that game. They threw Nathan Holler, they threw Jared Ryan, they threw Smith Pinson, and trailing by 4 runs here, you don't want to fire those best bullets just yet. Don't really know what the rest of the weekend holds. They're scheduled to play Thursday, Friday, Saturday. There's rain in the forecast Saturday. The games have not been moved to a doubleheader as of yet tomorrow, but that is a possibility for those of you watching at home. It hasn't yet happened, but it is a possibility with that forecast on Saturday. So therefore, you want to preserve those best bullets that you have down there in that pen when you're trailing like they are right here. They're turning it over to the freshman, hoping that he can hold this right there and let the offense scratch back in.
Stephen Hill will be the first man up. First time he'll be at the plate since taking a fastball off the head and his last at back in the top of the third. Glad to see that he's okay. Riggins' first pitch as he's set, kicks the leg and delivers. Fastball catches the outside corner for the strike call number one. 0-1 the count. Left-handed pitcher, kicks the leg again, delivers this one. Off-speed pitch misses inside, count now at one apiece. No outs here in the top of the fifth.
Miller Riggins, very talented freshman like Liberty's own Garrett Horn, who's starting tonight. Both teams expect big things out of these lefties over the next several years.
Check swing found off towards the Liberty Flames dugout. We'll move the count to 1-2, no outs. Kennesaw State, when allowing opponents to hit 2+ home runs, are 3-5 on the year. Flames with 2 so far in this ball game, both coming back in the fourth. Stephen Hill with a single and a hit by pitch his first two times. 1-2 pitch on the way from Riggins. Stayed up in the strike zone, never came down fully. Count now 2-2. Riggins gets the pitch call, twirls the ball in his glove, kicks the leg and delivers, swing and a miss. And he has his first strikeout.
Really good breaking ball right there. Started at the belt and broke through the strike zone. And Stephen Hill could not lay off of that one.
Final stat line for Jack Myers, who started this game for Kennesaw State. 4 innings pitched, 6 hits, 5 runs, 2 of those earned. 2 walks, 2 strikeouts, 1 hit by pitch, faced 22 batters, gave up 2 home runs, threw 90 pitches. Riggins' first pitch to Logan Matthew misses upstairs and away, 1-0. Riggins so far this year rocking an 8.10 ERA. 6.2 innings pitched. 1-0 count here to Matthew. Swing and a miss. One's across the board. 1 ball, 1 strike, 1 out here in the top of the fifth. Flames on top of the Owls by a score of 5-1. Liberty with 6 hits so far on the day. Kennesaw only with 2. And the Owls charged with 1 error as well. Riggins on the 1-1. Another swing and a miss from Matthew. Brings the count down to 1-2. Riggins looking at the dugout, getting the pitch call from pitching coach Matt Passeur. Here with 1 out in the top of the fifth. Riggins gets set, twirling the ball in his glove, kicks the leg and delivers the 1-2. Misses the strike zone. 2-2 now your count.
Plate umpire Eric Gauthier gave the sign that that ball was outside. A little disagreement from both the Owl fans and the Owl dugout as to that.
Matthew grounded out once to a fielder's choice and once to Donovan Cash. His first 2 times up here on the 2-2. We'll foul that one off and in towards the Austin Residence Complex. So down the third base line, and we'll retry the 2-2. Gave the stat earlier about when the Owls allow 2-plus home runs, they're 3-5. When the Flames hit home runs, they're 14-5 this year. Still a 5-1 lead here in the top of the fifth. Matthew looking to extend it here on the 2-2 pitch. That one bounces in front of Hassan, hits off the catcher's gear and behind him. Three and two now the count here with 1 out. Son did a nice job of trying to keep that one in front of him. Just too high of a bounce. Riggins now with the 3-2. That one's going to be fouled off of Matthew and behind.
Good battle here by the freshman. And Logan Matthew, who has now put himself inside the top 10 in Liberty history in home runs in a career.
Trying to continue to move up the list here with the 3-2 pitch, 1 out. Riggins is set and delivers. Misses upstairs. He'll walk. The Owls with one away allow a 1 out walk. Cameron Foster will step in. Singled his last time up.
We've talked to Coach Ryan Coe many times about what these Owls need to do to be successful. The first being throw strikes. The second being to play good defense, and they've had a little trouble with both of those so far this evening.
Riggins looks over at first, going to throw to the plate, inside. Foster has to move the hips back to avoid being hit. Want to know the count. Logan Matthew on first, unable to see the pitch. Same with the first base umpire having to use their hand to block out the sun.
It's that time of night here at Stillwell Stadium where it gets very difficult in right field and that right side of the infield.
1-0 pitch on the way, and Foster again misses inside. 2-0 now the count here. 1 out, top of the fifth. Flames on top of the Owls by 4.
Every stadium has their own unique home field advantage type of situation. At Liberty up in Lynchburg, once the ball gets above the stadium built there, it plays havoc. The wind wreaks havoc on that baseball, and many visiting teams have dropped pop-ups as a result.
Riggins again checking over at first. Will throw the 2-0. Misses inside again. 3-0 now the count.
here at Stillwell Stadium. It's the sun in right field. Back in 2018, the Owls won a game against Stetson on a Sunday afternoon where the right fielder lost the ball in the sun and two runs scored in the 10th inning.
3-0 count here, Riggins, on the delivery. That one bounces by the feet of Foster and a four-ball walk. We'll put runners on first and second, bringing up Brady Goligowski, who last time up hit the two-run shot to right field. Riggins also having to shield his eyes from the sun, trying to see the pitch call from the dugout. Gets the call as both runners will lead off. He'll check back second and first and throw the pitch to Goligowski. Misses upstairs for the first pitch, 1-0.
Mentioned earlier, both of these teams were driven by transfers. Brady Goligowski is one of those guys. Started out his career at NC State, transferred to Polk State before finding his way to Liberty in Lynchburg, Virginia.
Riggins on the 1-0 count, checks back at second, delivers the 1-0. Going to be driven to Hudson Mims at first. Chance for a double play. Get the first one at second. Throw to first. Will be in time. And the Owls with a double play to end the inning. We'll head to the bottom of the fifth. Looking to get the bat swinging as they trail by four here on the KSU Owl Network. Welcome back to Stillwell Stadium. Owls trail the visiting Liberty Flames by a score of 5-1. Flames when wearing these blue uniforms so far this season, 5-3. And currently hold a 4-run lead over Kennesaw State. Nick Kalina at the plate for the second time today. Second time also leading off in an inning. Watches the first pitch come inside. Just to back off of it. Back off the plate, rather, just a little bit to avoid being hit. First pitch, 1-0. Second one crosses the plate on the off speed to even the count at 1-1. Third base playing in. Shortstop and second on the grass. Same with first. 1-1 pitch going to be hit towards that third base side and roll foul.
Kalina almost snuck that one right by the drawn-in Cameron Foster. Just missed a double there.
Count now at 1-2. Here, no outs. Bottom of the fifth. Owls come into this game rocking an 8-game streak of 11-plus hits or more. Third pitch. Catches the outside corner. Garrett Horn gets another strikeout. Kalina, his second strikeout of the day, first time looking. And the Owls will head back to the top of their order with Josh Hatcher. Hit by a pitch his second time up, struck out his first time. Rocking an impressive hitting streak. Here with one out. The lights are on here at Stillwell Stadium as the sun goes down. First pitch misses upstairs, 1-0.
I I think it's safe to say that home plate umpire Eric Gaucher is not going to get an Easter basket from either dugout this weekend.
1-0 pitch. Hatcher will drive that one right up the middle, and his hit streak will stay alive. It's a single for Josh Hatcher. First hit of the inning here for Kennesaw State, and the Owls will try and rally. And, you know, Trey, I have to agree with you on that one. Not really any candy or anything like that going to be given to the home plate umpire.
Josh Hatcher extends that hitting streak to 27 games as he inches up the pecking order in Owl history.
Owls get their third hit on the day. First one since all the way back in the first inning. First pitch to Tyler Simon, misses for ball one. Hatcher stole a base earlier on in this game. Now 7-for-9 on the year. As Horn looks over at Hatcher, Simon half swing, umpire says he went around. Simon whips his head around, saying didn't think he went all the way. Coach Coe talking to the home plate umpire, unhappy with the call as those two are going back and forth. Unhappy that they didn't check with the first base umpire. 1-1 pitch, misses low, almost in the dirt. Nice job by Gray Betts to keep it in front of him. Count now at 2-1. Hatcher still standing on first, being held on by Logan Matthew. His time is called at the plate. Foster again playing shallow, not quite on the grass line at third base, just in the dirt a little bit. Back up as the 2-1 pitch comes in. That one in the dirt. Hatcher has to get back to first, no throw. Count moves to 3-1. Stephen Hill and Nathan Keeter all standing on the grass as well, with Matthew holding on Hatcher at first. Owls threatening with a walk. 3-1 the count here to Tyler Simon. Pitch on the way. And that one will miss the outside, to the outside, 4-1 count, will be a walk. This ball four comes across. So now Owls with one in scoring position with Donovan Cash at the plate, one out here in the bottom of the fifth. They trail by four by in a score of 5-1. Garrett Horn still on the mound here. Could be a big inning here for Kennesaw State to start this rally. Donovan Cash with a ground out to shortstop and a fly out his first two times up. Pitch crosses in the dirt. Crosses the plate in the dirt. 1-0 the count.
Hit the ball right on the button in his last at bat. A line out to center field in Derek Orndorff. See if he can make similar type of contact this time, but find a hole somewhere.
Horn gets the sign and gets set. Checks back to Hatcher at second. Will throw to the plate, 1-0 pitch, turns to 1-1.
Once again, he lands a breaking ball on that outside corner. That's been his go-to pitch this evening. When he has been in a tough spot or in a bad situation, even throwing one earlier in the game on a 3-0 count.
1-1 count here with one out in the bottom of the fifth. Swing and a miss by Donovan Cash. One from way down low to upstairs on Cash as the wind's starting to pick up here at the ballpark. Coming in from left field.
That's going to be the next step in Cash's development, laying off that fastball up.
Garrett Horn with the 1-2 pitch, ready to go, delivers. This is high. 2-2 now the count. Nice eye from Donovan Cash.
94 miles an hour on that one here in the fifth from Horn. So not missing a beat, has reached 97 miles an hour on the year out of the bullpen, according to head coach Scott Jackson.
2-2 pitch here to Donovan Cash with two runners on. Both runners will go, swing and a miss. Throw to third, Hatcher in there, safe. And the runners will move. one base. Strikeout for Donovan Cash in the scorecard. Both runners went, so Hatcher now standing on third. Simon safe at second. Throw from Betts was to third. Foster couldn't get the tag down in time.
So they're going to look to Cash Young here once again. He had a big two-out hit back in the first inning to give them their lone run. And he's had big hits time after time for the Owls. They're going to need him here again with two outs here in the bottom of the fifth, trailing 5-1.
It's 4:55 with two outs here for this Kennesaw State offense. First pitch, off speed, misses outside, 1-0.
And if he's going to do it, he might have to handle one of those sliders that Horn is throwing and definitely see the fastball down in the strike zone.
You mentioned the RBI single back in the first. Fielder's choice his last time up back in the third. 1-0 count here with two outs. Another off-speed pitch crosses the plate right in the middle. Now 1-1 count. Bottom of the fifth. Flames lead the Owls by four. Cash Young done a good job of situational hitting here so far in this season. Time called. Done a good job of situational hitting so far this season. Eight doubles, eight home runs on the year. That leads the team. Check swing. Check over at first. He says he doesn't go. 2-1 now your count. Here with two outs in the bottom of the fifth. 36 hits on the year and 122 at-bats. 27 runs, 30 RBIs. Looking to make it 31, maybe 32 here. On the 2-1 pitch from Garrett Horn. Pass ball will catch the outer part of the zone. Now a 2-2 count here with two outs.
That's four straight sliders right there from pitcher Garrett Horn. And in the Owls hitter's defense, that's a very tough pitch to pull the trigger on, landing on the back door time and time again. They're going to have to make an adjustment. Here's where he does like to come with the fastball with two strikes.
2-2 pitch, swing and a miss from Cash Young. Horns amped on the mound, gets his seventh strikeout of the day. And the Flames avoid any damage being done as we head to the top of the sixth. They still lead by four here on the KSU Owl Network. Back here at Stillwell Stadium, the Owls trail the Flames by a score of 5-1. The Owls had a chance to get runners in with runners on second and third, but Garrett Horn got his seventh strikeout on the day against Cash Young to get the Flames out of the inning. We'll catch you up on some out-of-town scoreboards. Currently in the top of the sixth, Central Arkansas on top of Eastern Kentucky 9-1. Also in the top of the sixth, North Alabama leads Lipscomb by a score of 6-2. And two other games going on, all A-Sun teams playing. FGCU on top 3-0 against UNF in the top of the fifth. And finally, Jacksonville State on the top of the fourth is up 1-0 on Bellarmine. Miller Riggins still in the ballgame here for Kennesaw State. First pitch, we called strike one.
FGCU looking to bounce back after being swept a week ago by these Liberty Frames to get the Flames back into contention here in the A-Sun East.
0-1 pitch. Fouled up high off the net and over towards our press box. Out of play. Now 0-2 the count to Nathan Keeter. Strikeout and a single so far today.
I have no doubt that Lucy Duncan on the camera would have made that catch had that one found its way in here.
Always ready. 0-2 pitch misses upstairs and away, 1-2. Special thanks to our production team so far today for working out all of our issues. Trying to make this broadcast as smooth as possible. Lucy Duncan, Aaron Cater, and Katie Klein-Peter all up here in the press box with Trey and I. 1-2 pitch from Riggins. Misses the strike zone. Now 2-2 the count. Nice job from Keeter to battle his way back. Keeter once hits 167 as a leadoff man so far this season. 1-2 today here with Riggins on the bump. 2-2 pitch. Misses upstairs. 3-2 now your count. 69 at-bats on the season. 15 hits, 12 runs, 6 RBIs.
Very important first out here with the leadoff man on deck for Miller Riggins and the Owls.
3-2 pitch. Riggins looking to get a strikeout here. Throws it. That one misses outside. Walks Keeter. And the Flames get a leadoff walk.
Once again, that borderline 1-2 pitch goes against Riggins and the Owls. And then the next two out of the zone end up in a leadoff walk.
Sweatshirts coming on here for the fans at Stillwell Stadium. A good crowd here on a Thursday night matchup in Kennesaw. Top of the sixth, Flames lead the Owls 5-1. Runner on and Keeter, he's on first. Back at the top of the order with Gray Betts. Left-handed batter versus the left-handed pitcher.
And freshman Slade Notterman warming up in the bullpen for the Owls. So the Owls are going to rely on a couple of freshmen here to try to keep this game close and give their offense a chance in the latter innings, which is a tall, tall task against this Liberty Flames bullpen.
Gray Betts 0-3 today. All three groundouts to Hudson Mims at second. Second pitch from Riggins on the 1-0. Misses upstairs and away. Now 2-0. Donovan Cash at first. Holding Nathan Keeter on, the second baseman today here for the Flames. Keeter with the leadoff. Cash still over there. Sunglasses off. Riggins looks over at him. Checks it again. Going to throw home. Catches the strike zone on the outside. Now 2-1.
Betts showed bunt his last at bat. Cash Young playing back once again at third base. Wouldn't be surprised to see him drop one down.
2-1 count here to Betts. Has to turn away from that one as it just barely missed him on the inside and upstairs. Now 3-1.
In his last at bat, Gray Betts took a 3-1 pitch. That was called strike two before grounding out to Mims. I wouldn't be surprised to see him take another one here and make the young freshman get in the strike zone.
3-1 count, no outs. Keeter on first. He'll go to second, 4-for-4 in the air. Hassan, the throw to Tyler Simon, not in time. So Nathan Keeter now 5-for-5 on the year and stolen bases. Umpires will move around. Pitch got in there for a strike, so now a 3-2 count with a runner on scoring position in Keeter. Betts hits 311 with runners on. 38% on base percentage. 3-2 pitch here. Miller Riggins kicks the leg and throws to Gray Betts. That one's going to be fouled off down the third base side. We'll try the 3-2 again.
Gray Betts approach very similar to the Owls' Nick Kalina. Sees a lot of pitches, generally does not chase a ball out of the strike zone, and makes a pitcher work for every single out they get against him.
Riggins again checks Keeter at second. Simon gives him the okay to throw as that one's going to be driven into the right field. There to make the catch will be Braden Edson. Throw to second base to Tyler Simon. Will hold Keeter there, and the Owls have their first out of the inning. They still trail by 4. As Aaron Anderson, the right fielder, with a single today. 1-for-3 on the day. We'll step into the batter's box to face off against the freshman in Riggins.
Switch hitter will flip over to the right side to face the lefty Riggins.
Batting 312 on the year, 267 with runners in scoring position. Takes that one and drives it center field. Hatcher there. Big leadoff from Keeter. Ball still in the air. Going to be caught by Hatcher for the second out. Keeter's forced again to stay at second.
And with Orndorff coming up, I wouldn't be surprised to see Coach Coe put him on and face the left-hander in 3 Hillier rather than pitching here again to Orndorff.
And that's exactly what he's going to do, an intentional walk. Coach Coe points to the umpire, and taking a base will be Derek Orndorff. So Betts and Anderson both fly out. Betts to right field and Edson. Anderson to center to Hatcher. First two outs of the inning here for Kennesaw State. An intentional walk. Derek Orndorff puts two runners on, a runner on first and a runner on second, bringing up number 3 Hillier, left fielder. A single, a walk, and a fly out so far today. His fourth time at the plate now. Riggins checks second at Keeter. We'll throw home. Off-speed pitch. Nice curveball there. 1-1 the count here. Two outs. And the top of the sixth, where the Flames lead the Owls by 4.
And if you're the lefty Riggins, this is the guy you have to get. You need to get the lefty to end the inning.
Son will call time. Give some signs to the infield and Miller Riggins. He'll check the armband, see what those are, step back on the mound, and lean in. Gets ready, check the runners. Likes what he sees, throws inside, now 1-1. Stephen Hill in the on-deck circle with a single, a strikeout, and a hit-by-pitch today. Good to see him still in the game after the scary fastball hit off the back of his helmet. Still a 1-1 count here with two outs, runners on first and second for Riggins. He'll throw home. Check swing. He did go around and Hillier. Called for strike number 2 as that one was in the dirt. So now a 1-2 count here with two outs and the top of the sixth.
3 straight breaking balls there, left on left from Riggins, the third one being the best one he's thrown thus far. Getting Keeter to chase, or getting Hillier to chase in the dirt.
Owls have allowed 6 hits today, looking to get out of this inning without allowing one here. 1-2 pitch. Hillier leaned out, then leaned back in.
And that's just a case of Miller Riggins trying to do too much with that breaking ball. He wanted to throw the one he threw, 1-1, to get it to 1-2 in the dirt. He pulled off of it a little bit. The release point came a little further back away from the plate, and the ball stayed high there.
2-2 count here with two outs. Two's across the board. Riggins will check back at second. Throws home. Swinging a foul ball high up off the net behind home plate. Count remains at 2-2.
Tried to sneak a fastball by him after 4 straight breaking balls, and a good job right there by Hillier to get a piece and stay alive. Wouldn't be surprised to see Riggins go back to the breaking ball one more time. See if he can get the one in the dirt and get Hillier to chase it to end this top of the sixth inning.
Be big here for the Owls to get out of it, not load the bases. 2-2 count here with two outs in the top of the sixth. Owls trail by 4. Riggins checks back at second, going to throw home on the 2-2. That one misses low. Good eye there from Hillier. Just thought, watch that one by. Now a 3-2 count.
Went back to the fastball there. Now you've got a full count. Runners are going to be on the move. Be interesting to see what Riggins and Coach Matt Passauer decide to do here. Big pitch in the ballgame.
3-2 pitch. Riggins checks back at second, kicks the leg and delivers. Misses inside. That'll load the bases on a walk. Second walk of the inning for Miller Riggins and this Owls pitching staff.
I think I've seen home plate umpire Eric Gaucher signal where pitches were after complaints from the dugout more times than a home plate umpire has all season long. Having to justify where he's calling these pitches missing at.
Head coach Ryan Coe had some words for.
And it's been both sides. Head coach Scott Jackson was upset earlier in the game. Now head coach Ryan Coe for the Owls upset here. Not quite sure where these pitches are missing. The beauty of technology is after the game's over, the TrackMan printout will give head coach Ryan Coe and his staff a great indicator of just how home plate umpire Eric Gauthier did tonight in this ball game. They'll get a very good idea. Sometimes it's hard to see. It's hard to see from those dugouts, first and third base dugouts, in and out, and you assume that the ball is a strike, and it might not be a strike. So they'll go back, look at that after the game, and they'll know exactly whether this was a well-umpired game behind the plate or not.
First mound visit to Miller Riggins. Saw that as an issue in the Georgia game.
And I got some clarification on what happened in that Georgia game. When Matt Pasur went out to the mound, the home plate umpire thought he signaled for the bullpen. It had nothing to do with the number of visits. He thought he signaled for the pitcher out of the pen, and he did not. The umpire was just incorrect.
Two outs here in the top of the sixth. Check swing at first. First base umpire, and Stephen Hagen says he doesn't go around. That one missed upstairs, 1-0.
So this is a big at bat in this game for a few reasons, but number one, if the Flames get a hit here, they can preserve some of their better arms in the pen and save them for later in this series.
1-0 pitch. Right down the middle, we'll go for strike number one, now 1-1.
If you're the Owls, you want to make sure you can hold this lead right here, so the Flames are forced to throw some of those better bullets. And even in a loss, you could win a little bit if you get those best arms into the ballgame.
Riggins still in the game here on 1-1. Two outs in the top of the sixth. Swing and a miss from Stephen Hill. We'll move to the count to 1-2. Big pitch here for Miller Riggins, the freshman.
And this is what you want to see if you're the coaching staff for the Owls. How will this freshman handle this situation? At some point, you've got to throw them in the fire and see how they respond. Let's see how Miller Riggins responds here.
1-2 pitch, Riggins delivers. That one's going to be found off down the right sideline towards the old soccer field. We'll try the 1-2 again. Houston High School product on the bump here, looking to get a crucial strikeout in this ballgame and keep the lead at 4 for this Flames offense. One-two count here with a four-run lead for the Flames. Pitch misses upstairs, now 2-2, with twos across the board.
Hill was the first batter Riggins faced when he came in an inning ago, and he got him swinging on a breaking ball down out of the zone. Let's see if he goes back to it and tries to get him the same way again.
2-2 count, Hill at the plate. Awaits the pitch, fouls it off again down that first base line. Nice job by him to stay alive.
The second at bat, Riggins sticking with the fastball here, trying to force contact, trying to challenge Hill.
Riggins trying everything he has in his playbook to try and beat Stephen Hill. He'll try it again here with the bases loaded with two outs in the top of the sixth. Riggins kicks the leg and delivers the 2-2. Hassan forced to reach up and chase. 3-2 now the count.
Quality at bat here from the fifth year shortstop, Stephen Hill, versus the freshman, Miller Riggins.
Big pitch in this ballgame here on the 3-2 count with two outs, top of the six. Kicking the leg and the throw. That one's going to be driven. Tyler Simon jumps up for it, can't get it, and that will score 1-2 comes around. And that will partially unload the bases. Runner still on first and second, and the Flames tack on another two to extend the lead. Now 7-1.
So Riggins stuck with the fastball. All fastballs right there to Stephen Hill after getting him with the breaking ball the at-bat before. And finally, Hill catches up to it, lines it over Tyler Simon's head, and that is a big hit for the Flames to extend this lead out to six. And as I mentioned before, the Owls are going to have to do something offensively to, at worst, ensure that some of the better arms are used out of that Flames bullpen.
The Owls will have to try again to get out of this inning here. Runner still on first and second. Logan Matthew, the first baseman at the plate, walked his last time up. Riggins' first pitch called strike one. Flames now get their seventh hit on the day. Seven runs scored. Owls with three and only one run to their name. Flag still blown in left field into the ballpark here at Stillwell Stadium, where the Flames extend their lead now 7-1 here in the top of the sixth with two outs. Riggins checks back at second. Will throw to the home plate. Matthew gets a tip on it and fouls it back to the screen, now 0-2.
And all three base runners that reached base prior to that single reached on a walk. Leadoff walk to Keeter. Intentional walk to Orndorff. Walk to Hillier before the single by Stephen Hill.
Riggins ahead on the count, 0-2 here to Logan Matthew. He delivers. Misses upstairs, now 1-2.
Four of the Flames' seven runs on the night have reached by walk or error, and that is the area that we've identified several times that the Owls cannot have happen if they want to stay in this ball game and beat a quality team like the Flames.
Riggins again keeps checking back at second. We'll throw the 1-2, a swing and a miss. Second strikeout on the day for Miller. Riggins gets the Owls out of the inning, not before damage is done by the Flames to extend the lead to 7-1. You're listening to KSU Baseball here on the KSU Owl Network. Welcome back to Stillwell Stadium here. The Owls trail the Flames by a score of 7-1. Liberty with one run in the first, four in the fourth, and another two back here, and we head to the bottom of the sixth. They tack on two more in the top part of this inning. Owls only run coming in the bottom part of the first, but before we get back under play, Trey Fowler has a nice little trivia question for us here.
A little KSU Owls trivia here. This one actually pertains to both KSU and Liberty. So if you're watching along on YouTube and you want to try to answer it, reach out to me on S at Twitter on at STF3333, or if you have my cell number, text me, and I'll give you a shout-out for getting this right. The Owls secured their first win over Liberty in the D1 era opening day 2015 by 11-9 final score. Who closed the door on that victory and earned the save? Owls secured their first win opening day 2015, 11-9. Who had the save for the Owls in that game?
If you know the answer, be sure to tweet Trey at STF3333. That's four threes. Or, as he said, if you have his number, go ahead and text him. Owls looking to get back in this game with Hudson Mims. Takes the first pitch for ball number one. 1-0 on the count. He's ahead. Second one, he's fouled down the third base side towards that Owls dugout where there's more action and the bullpen. 1-1 now the count.
Flames lead the all-time series against the Owls 11-3. With that first win, like I said, coming in 2015.
1-1 pitch turns to 1-2 as that fastball catches the upper part of the zone. 1-2 count. Here, no outs in the bottom of the sixth. The Flames now lead the Kennesaw State Owls by a score of 7-1, tacking on another two runs in the top part of this sixth inning. Aaron Horns, 1-2 pitch, misses outside on the breaking ball. 2-2 now.
Little fun fact about that game, Bryce. that game in 2015 almost did not happen. You want to venture a guess as to what almost caused postponement?
2-2 pitch, swung and missed by Hudson Mims. He'll get the strikeout. And Garrett Horn. I'm going to go tornado.
Tornado's a good guess. A good guess. We actually had someone drive through the right field wall the night before opening day. And there was a huge hole in the wall, a huge hole down the right field line where the batting cages are. Actually tore the batting cages down. But we were able to get a fence company out here that morning and get it fixed to play that game.
So the Hudson Mims strikeout gets Garrett Horn his eighth on the day. Nick Hassan now at the plate. Always something, Trey, isn't it? Always something.
Seen games canceled for a lot of reasons. A wreck out or crash out through the right field fence is not one I've seen to this point.
1-0 pitch with one out here to Nick Hassan. Now goes 2-0 as that one crossed inside. Fans still here at Stillwell. Seeing if the Owls can mount a comeback here in the bottom of the sixth. Nick Hassan takes the third pitch of the at-bat for strike number one. Now 2-1 the count here with one out in the bottom of the sixth. One pitch on the way. Hassan fouls that up over the press box, on top of the press box. We hear the thud above us. 2-2 now the count to Nick Hassan, the Buster Posey watch list candidate. Two pitch on the way. Again, fouled off, this time high off the screen. Stays in play. Goes over towards Liberty dugout. Garrett Horn doing a nice job so far of containing this Owls offense. Allowed only one run so far. 2-2 pitch on the way from Horn. Foul tip.
We talked a little bit about how Liberty had flipped their infield quite a bit over the last couple of weeks. They also flipped their rotation quite a bit over the last few weeks, with Horn going into the rotation on Friday nights. And I'll tell you, after watching him throw so far tonight into the sixth here, with what his stuff does and how good his stuff is, along with the performance that he's put up there, he could be find himself in this spot for the Flames for a long, long time, pitching on Friday nights and wreaking havoc in the A-Sun in the future.
2-2 pitch to Hassan with one out. That one in and out of the glove. Wonder if that one stayed in the glove of catcher Gray Betts, if that would have been called strike three. But the Flames this year, when their starting pitcher goes 5-plus innings, are 9-1 on the season. Horn now 6 1/3 through this game. 3-2 pitch on the way. That one's going to be chopped. Nice jumping catch in and out of the glove of the second baseman, Nathan Keeter. And Nick Hassan will get on with one out, bringing up Braden Edson, who foul out in a bunt.
It's a good job.
First two times.
Good job there by Keeter. That'll go down as a hit for Hassan. That ball was hit straight over the top of his head. Sometimes that is the hardest one for an outfielder or an infielder to make the play on. He did a good job gaining ground, had it in the glove, just lost it as he hit back on the ground.
Edson drives that one left field. Coming over to make the grab will be three. Hillier, diving effort. Slides over on the warning track off the third baseline. Doesn't make the grab.
And Hillier had him shaded towards that line, and that's the reason why he had an opportunity to possibly make that catch right there. A heck of an effort diving in the gravel on the warning track over there, just out of his reach.
Count now 0-1 here with one out. Owls trail the Flames by six. It's a 7-1 ball game here in the bottom of the sixth inning. Braden Edson at the plate with Nick Hassan on first. We'll drive it to Keeter again. A chance for redemption. Gets the first play for the double play. Unable to get the second out. Over at first was Matthew. So the Flames get the lead run around Hassan. Edson will be safe at first and reach on a fielder's choice. With Spencer Hansen now at the dish. Hanson, a designated hitter today with a strikeout and a ground out to Keeter. First pitch crosses. Low in the zone, 1-0. Temperature starting to cool down here in Kennesaw. 1-0 pitch comes across. Called strike one, now 1-1. Sweatshirts and long sleeves starting to be put on by both players and fans. As the Flames currently lead the Owls by a score of 7-1. 1-1 pitch way up high, in and out of the glove of Betts. Edson doesn't go, he'll stay, count now 2-1. Betts forced to stand up to stop that one. Kalina on deck here for Kennesaw State in the bottom of the sixth. With Hanson trying to start a rally here with two outs. Talked about timely hitting earlier, the Flames have done it. Owls looking to do that as well. It's actually not Spencer Hanson at the plate anymore. It's Gavin Patel. You can see the numbers from here. 3-1 to him. He'll pop that one up and backwards over the press box. Now 3-2 count here with two outs.
Gavin Patel, the transfer from Gordon State. Played all four infield positions so far for the Owls in his career.
He'll take a walk on that one, and that'll put two runners on the bases here with Nick Kalina stepping up to bat. Kalina can load the bases and get on here. We've seen what Josh Hatcher can do with the bases loaded.
Three grand slams and his four home runs on the year. And that'll bring pitching coach Matt Williams to the mound to slow this one down a little bit and give that Flames bullpen some time to get to work. Get you a number on him. It appears to be Trey Carter, but we'll confirm that here in just 1 second.
Right now, just a mound meeting. So Edson on second. Patel standing on first. Does a nice job stepping in to draw a walk. Umpire going to go out and break up the powwow on the mound.
And that is, in fact, Trey Carter warming up for the Flames in their bullpen. Another power arm, also up to 97 miles an hour this year for the Flames. Watching them play early in the year, it was evident that this team was equally as good as the team they had a year ago. And now with Garrett Horn stabilizing Friday nights, just like Trevor DeLate did a year ago, these Flames will be a force to be reckoned with in the second half as they try to mount a comeback on these Owls that sit alone atop first place in the Heysun East standings by three games.
Nick Kalina with two strikeouts today, looking to get on and load the bases. And Trey, you're going to have to remind me here. Is that the first or the second mound visit for Horn today? I believe that's the first.
That's the second.
That
is the second time Coach Williams has been out.
So next time there'll be a mound visit. He'll be forced to come out of the game. Here, two outs with two runners on here for Kennesaw State and Nick Kalina at the plate. Check swing, still called strike. Count now at 1-1 here with two outs. Field playing pretty deep except this left side and third baseman Cameron Foster. Horn gets set, kicks a leg and throws. Off speed breaking ball gets in there for strike number two. A good pitch from him.
The Owls are going to need to Nick Kalina to battle here. He's done a great job the last several weeks of extending innings, getting on base, and getting Hatcher to the plate in these bases loaded situations. They need him to do it here.
Another big pitch in this ballgame. The 1-2 bounces in the dirt. Horn will rush out to try and stop anybody from stealing a base. Nobody went. Count moves now to 2-2.
Good decision right there by Edson. You don't want to make the third out at third base, especially trailing by six runs. So good decision to stay right where he's at.
And with Horn being a lefty, that would have been a much easier throw than going to second. Kalina now with a 2-2 count here. Two outs in the bottom of the six. Owls and the Flames here from Stillwell Stadium. Flames on top 7-1. Owls looking to rally. Kick of the leg and a step off. Checking back Edson and a little bit of a stare down. On second base. Still twos across the board. Leaning back in his horn. He'll get the pitch. Check first and check second. Kick the leg and throw. And again in the dirt on a try to fastball. Count now at 3-2.
Full count, two outs. Runners will be on the move on the pitch.
3-2 count, two outs, bottom of the six. Six-run lead here for the Flames. Stillwell Stadium, Bryce Colbert, Trey Fowler on the call. As the 3-2 pitch is on its way, swing and a miss. Horn does a little shimmy on the mound and walks off and gets his team out of the inning. When we come back, we'll head to the top of the seventh. Flames back at the plate, and they lead 7-1.
Concerts and theater events. Visit TicketSmarter.com and download the app tonight. Don't miss out. Smart fans start at TicketSmarter.com. Pitching for the Owls, number 32, Slade Nettleman.
Welcome back here to Stillwell Stadium. New pitcher into the game here for Kennesaw State will be number 32, Slade Nettleman. Trey, what's the rundown on him?
Otterman will be making his third appearance on the year. He's thrown two innings so far, one hit, two runs. They were both earned, one walk, three strikeouts. Had a very good debut outing in which he struck out the side. He's a two-way player, catcher-pitcher, which you don't see that combination very often, but he's a freshman, played in the 6-4-3 program, just like former Owl and current Rome Brave Tyler Tolvey. Run the fastball up there, top out around 92 miles an hour with a really good breaking ball. So once again, we'll continue the line of freshmen to see if they can hold these Flames right where they're at. Just a reminder, the trivia question pertained to a little Owls and Flames history. The Owls secured their first win over Liberty in the D1 area opening day 2015 by 11-9 final score. Who closed the door on that victory and earned the save? For the Owls, who closed the door and earned the save for the Owls in that first game that they won against the Flames in their D1 history. Still waiting for answers. If you think you know it, reach out to me on Twitter, STF3333. That's STF3333. Or if you know me and have my cell number, text it to me. We'll give you a shout out online. Thanks for all those following on YouTube. Special shout out goes to Kevin Simmons, the brother of former KSU assistant coach and current Indiana Hoosier assistant coach Derek Simmons watching on YouTube. And we're back here for the seventh. Bryce, take us away.
Notterman looking to limit any damage, more damage done here as the first pitch bounces in the dirt and off Hassan's arm as Cameron Foster is up at the plate. One-oh count here in the top of the seventh. The Flames lead 7-1. Second pitch again in the dirt. That one bounces off the dirt and up on the screen. Now 2-0. Another special thanks to all of our production crew here today. Aaron Cater, Katie Kleinpeter, and Lucy Duncan all helping us out, making this broadcast run as smoothly as possible and working through all the technical problems we had earlier. Bryce Colbert and Trey Fowler on the call here from Stillwell Stadium. as that one's going to be fouled off down the right sideline. Count now 2-1. Final numbers on Miller Riggins. Two innings pitched, one hit, two runs. Both runs were earned. Five walks, two strikeouts, 11 batters faced. 8.64 ERA. 2-1 pitch to Foster. Upper part of the strike zone and catches it. Now 2-2.
Not a bad job by Riggins. For a freshman, he made one bad pitch. That pitch to Hill that allowed two runs to score. Preceding that, a couple of walks that put him in that trouble. But not a bad outing.
2-2 pitch on the way from Notterman to Foster. This is inside. Tried a breaking ball. Couldn't get it cut enough. 3-2 now your count. Overall pitching ERA from Kennesaw State pitchers today, 4.57. Only pitcher in the game for the Flames. The 3-2 pitch misses outside for a walk to Foster. Leadoff walk. Garrett Horn, the only pitcher so far through six for the Flames. With a 1.63 ERA, his total on the year is a 1.65.
That's the ninth walk for Owl pitchers today, coming off of 13 walks against the Bulldogs in the 17-15 loss on Tuesday night.
First pitch to Brady Golikowski, called strike one.
That's something they're going to have to get corrected if they want to win this series and maintain first place in the A-Sun Eastern Division standings through the first rotation here in 2022.
Clean sweep here for the Flames. They would tie the Owls conference record. 0-1 pitch turns to 1-1. This is upstairs on the fastball.
And once again, how the A-Sun is set up this year, you have an East Division with six teams, a West Division with six teams. Each team plays the other five teams in their division six times, both home and away. This concludes the first round of play. And starting next weekend, everybody will reset, go play each other one more time.
1-1 pitch, swing and a miss. Ball gets behind Hassan, and Foster will move to second on a wild pitch. Golikowski took a chop at it, almost made contact with it, turning it a foul ball.
And this game this evening is very similar to the first game that these two teams played back in 2021 up in Lynchburg, Virginia. The Owls entered that series needing four wins to win the A-Sun regular season. The Flames needed three wins to win the A-Sun regular season. And a little bit of bad defense in that game cost the Owls game one up there.
1-2 pitch, swing and a miss. Gets away from Hassan, throw to first. We'll still get the strikeout credited to Slade Nonnerman. Owls get the out for the first one of the inning.
Second baseman,
so a swinging strikeout will be credited to Brady Golikowski, and a strikeout to Slade Nonnerman. We'll bring up Nathan Keeter. Strikeout, a single, and a walk so far with a stolen base.
What those two games have in common, the first game from 2021 and the first game this year in 2022, is a tremendous performance by the Liberty starting pitcher.
Showing bunt was Keeter. He pulled it back.
Both of those outings by left-handers. Now student assistant for the Liberty Frames, Trevor DeLate, the main transfer through that game a year ago on Friday night in Lynchburg.
Second pitch, misses low in the dirt, now 2-0.
DeLate actually beat the Owls three times in the span of the month, two in the regular season, one in the conference tournament, throwing complete games each time and holding down the A-Sun's best offense from a year ago, three consecutive games.
2-0 count here with one out in the top of the seventh. Flames lead the Owls 7-1. Swing and a miss from Keeter. Moves the count to 2-1. Foster on second with the leadoff walk, and it's advanced to second on a wild pitch.
Notterman still very relatively new to pitching. Started picking it up a little bit more last year, his senior year in high school.
Right-handed pitcher facing off against right-handed batter. Fastball misses the strike zone, now 3-1.
Notterman from Roswell, Georgia, attended the Weber School.
Owls looking to avoid their ninth walk on the day, as you mentioned earlier, Trey. 3-1 pitch, and they will get that ninth walk. Saw a lot of walks against Georgia, seeing now 9 walks here against the Flames. Not what the Owls are looking for, as the umpires will switch positions. As we head back to the top of the order with Gray Betts for his 5th at-bat of the evening.
10-3 base runner on the evening. 9 walks, 1 hit by pitch.
Three ground outs to Hudson Mims at second and a fly out to Edson and Wright for Betts so far today. Launches the first pitch and high and away for ball number one. Flames, as you've we've mentioned all night, Trey, done a good job of situational hitting. Notterman on the 1-0. Misses inside, now 2-0. We now see some more action in that Owls bullpen.
5 of their 7 runs so far have scored with 2 outs on the night. Started things off with a 2-out single in the first to score their first run. Orndorff had a 2-out home run back in the 4-run fourth.
Only 1 out here is that one again. Hit over to Mims. Wanted to go for the double play. Didn't have it in time. Simon wasn't fully covering second, so elected to just throw it to first to Donovan Cash for the easy out. Runners will advance, so.
That's a good decision right there by the freshman Mims. Sometimes young players like to try and force that throw to second to get the lead runner. Had he have done that there, everybody could have been safe. So a really good decision. The 4th assist off of the bat of Gray Betts by Hudson Mims this evening.
Betts 0 for 5 tonight, as you just mentioned, 4th time. Been hit over to Mims. First pitch off speed. Forced Aaron Anderson to tuck in on it. Didn't hit him, missed inside, still 1-0. Here are 2 outs in the top of the 7th, Flames and the Owls, where Liberty leads by 6.
Coach Coe voicing his displeasure once again with the strike zone of Mr. Gaucher behind the plate.
1-0 pitch, fouled off towards that Flames dugout.
And I think the statement that he made is a valid one. Nobody knows where the strike zone is the words that came out of Coach Coe's mouth in the dugout. And that has been the theme of the evening.
Donnerman checking the belt, which has all the pitch card on it. Still going to lean in and see where Hassan wants it. Checks back at second. Runners on second and third in scoring position. 1-1 pitch. Going to be driven into right field. Edson going to knock it under it. Misjudged it. It's going to get past him as well. Hatcher going to have to deal damage control. Going to throw into Simon, the cutoff man. Both runs will score in a double. A 2-RBI double, rather. Will extend this Flames lead to 9-1. Another 2-out hit for Liberty.
Be interesting to see how that one is scored. Definitely give Anderson the 2 RBIs. The hit could go down as a single and an error on Edson to allow Anderson to get to second. Just misjudged that one a little bit. Broke back. The ball was hit with some top spin. It lands in front of him. And Liberty has blown this one wide open here in the 7th.
Runner on second and Anderson brings up Derek Orndorff. Check swing on that one. See if he went all the way around. Check it first. Home plate umpire doesn't need to go to first. Says he does. 0-1 the count here. 2 outs. Top part at 7. 9-1 lead here for Liberty. They tack on another 2 runs. 8 hits for the Flames tonight. Orndorff fouls that one off down the first baseline and onto the old soccer field. 0-2 now here, 2 outs.
And that's 2 more runs with 2 outs here for the Flames, 7 on the evening.
And Trey, they did exactly that. They scored a single and an error by Edson. So the 2nd error on the night here for Kennesaw State, only 2 errors of the game. Notterman watched Anderson lean off at 2nd. Stared at him for a little bit, faked a throw. Nobody was covering. Back and forth. Owl had movement, forced a Layoff, throwing a pitch again. 0-2 the count here to Derek Orndorff. A walk, a home run, and an intentional walk tonight on this home run. It was a two-run shot. Pitch to him. Otterman thought he had that one on to end the inning. Umpire disagreed. 1-2 now the count here, two outs.
And that's a tough one. A lot of movement there by Hassan. Tough to get that pitch called a strike, even if it did catch the corner.
Gonna have to reset it. Still watch it. Anderson at second will throw home. 1-2 bounces in the dirt. Hit off the batter's bat as he was bringing it down. Got away from him. 2-2 count here with two outs. Flames tack on two runs here in the top of the seventh to extend their lead to 8. It's a 9-1 ball game here at Stillwell Stadium. Bryce Gobert, Trey Fowler on the call.
And the biggest thing that the Flames have been able to do by extending this lead is keep Mason Fluardi.
Called strike three. Slade Notterman gets out of the inning. Trey, we'll come back to you whenever we head to the bottom of the seventh. It's the Owls and the Flames here on the KSU Owl Network. Owls trail by 8. Welcome back to Stillwell Stadium. The Liberty Flames extend their lead to 9-1 here as we have a new pitcher on the bump. Will be number 6, Trey Carter. And Trey Fowler, what's the rundown on him?
Trey Carter's a really good arm here in his sophomore year for the Flames. Going to mix the fastball, 92, 96 miles an hour. Likes to work ahead with it, then looks to finish with a really good breaking ball. 76% of his strikeouts this year coming on that breaking ball. So far on the season for Mr. Carter, he is no record, 2.12 ERA in 11 appearances, 17 innings pitched, 11 hits, 6 runs, 4 earned, 10 walks, and 21 strikeouts, and he'll be facing the top of the Owls order.
Continued his hit streak to 27 tonight, Josh Hatcher. Only one single so far, as well as a stolen base. Two stolen bases, rather. Up for the fourth time. And we'll see what Trey Carter can do versus him. First pitch inside, almost catches Hatcher on the knee. 1-0 the count.
Trey Carter was a two-way guy for Liberty last year, exclusively pitching so far this year. No at-bats.
Second one's going to be driven right field, going back at the wall. Hatcher has left the yard. Josh Hatcher continues to do damage as he registers his 5th home run on the year and puts the Owls on the board once again to cut the lead to 9-2.
They put up a graphic on the ESPN broadcast the other night that showed and compared Josh Hatcher to Max Pentecost, who was the last KSU player to win the A-Sun Player of the Year honors. In the two seasons, Josh Hatcher's 2022 season and Max Pentecost's 2014 season are very similar to this point.
Trey Carter comes in, gives up a home run, now has to face Tyler Simon. A double and two walks, as well as a stolen base. Scored all the way back in the first, the other run here for KSU. First pitch, Mitch, for a ball, 1-0 the count. Second one also low, now 2-0.
Started to talk about it a little bit before last half inning. The Flames extending this lead can give guys like Mason Fluardi the night off.
That one's going to be driven down the third base side and get tucked under the tarp. 2-1 now the count.
Mason Fluardi, Cade Hungate, David Erickson, those are the top arms out of the Liberty bullpen. And if they can maintain this lead, they can give them rest and make sure they're ready to go for the rest of the weekend. The Owls want to prevent that from happening at worst.
2-1 count gets in there for strike number two. Now 2-2 as that one caught the inside part of the zone.
92 miles an hour from Carter on that one. So for the Owls, you're fighting here. Obviously, you want to win this game, but at worst, you want to see some of those top arms have to toe the rubber tonight, and hopefully their stuff's a little bit worse tomorrow.
2-2 pitch missed low. May have caught the plate as it got in. 3-2 now the count here to Tyler Simon. Still no outs. Owls tack on their first run since all the way back in the first inning. It's now a 9-2 ball game. Fifth hit on the day courtesy of a Josh Hatcher solo home run. Simon will walk here and bring up Donovan Cash. So the Owls starting to get some offensive production here a little bit later on in this game in the bottom of the seventh. Still trail by seven.
And that's what you've got to do if you're the Owls. You've got to take it one at bat at a time. There are no seven-run home runs. So you've got to take it one at bat at a time. Keep passing it down to the guy behind you. Put some pressure on this Flames team and see what happens.
Trey Carter with a home run and a walk, his first two batters. Comes to Donovan Cash and throws the first pitch strike. Final stat line on Garrett Horn, 6 innings pitch, 4 hits, 1 run, which was earned, 4 walks, 9 strikeouts, 1 wild pitch, 1 hit by pitch as well, 27 batters faced. 0-1 turns to 0-2 as Carter scratches the lower part of the strike zone now. Looking for his first strikeout on the night. Right-handed pitcher versus a right-handed batter. The 0-2 in the dirt. Simon stays at first.
Very impressive night for the starter, Garrett Horn. Sometimes it's hard to step into the limelight on Friday night in the A Sun and turn in a performance like he did, but he did exactly that.
102 pitches on the night for Garrett Horn. 1-2 pitch to Donovan Cash, a little bit low.
You think
now 2-2.
You think about some of the best arms that have pitched in the A-Sun, guys the likes of Logan Gilbert. He did not even start on Friday nights for Stetson as a freshman in the A-Sun. He threw on Sundays. He didn't move to Fridays until his junior year.
2-2 pitch. That one came in on the hands of Donovan Cash. He came around on it, swung, jammed him up. Brought it off backwards towards the screen. Now 2-2 still. And we'll try it again. Tyler Simon still standing on first, being held on and holding the conversation with Logan Matthew. Shortstop and second playing on the grass dirt line. Same with third base and Cameron Foster. 2-2 pitch. That one's going to be hit. And Keeter makes the grab. Simon had to race back to first to avoid the double play. So the Flames get their first out of the inning. And Cash Young now, another right-handed batter at the plate for Kennesaw State. We'll try to continue the inning.
I think what you're seeing recently from teams against Donovan Cash, they're trying to exploit him on that inside corner.
First pitch to Cash Young is hit high into right field. Getting under it will be Aaron Anderson. He'll make the grab. Tyler Simon will return to first base, and just like that in 2 pitches, the Flames get 2 outs.
Going back to Donovan Cash, he's had a lot of his doubles this year to right center field, and I think teams have noticed that. Now they're trying to hammer him in with the hard stuff and jam him up, and Georgia had success a little bit on Tuesday night. Liberty's had some success here tonight, so the redshirt freshman will need to make some adjustments to keep producing.
Hudson Mims will drive that one down the third base line. It'll pull just foul. Would have been some extra base hits, Trey. And you saw left fielder Three Hillier playing pretty far over.
Speaking of making adjustments, one thing Coach Coe identified on the production call this week was the fact that this freshman in the box, Hudson Mims, had to make some adjustments over the last few weeks, has been hitting it over a 400 clip since those adjustments, and that's what hitting's all about. They start to figure you out, you make some adjustments, and make them figure you out again.
0-1 pitch to him, swings at that one in the dirt. Wild pitch gets away for from catcher Gray Betts. Tyler Simon will advance on a wild pitch. Now the Owls have one in scoring position on an 0-2 count. Mims swung at that one as it was way outside. 0-2 count here with two outs. Bottom of the seventh. Flames and the Owls here from Stillwell Stadium. Liberty currently holds a 9-2 lead with Hubson Mims at the plate. Trey Carter leans in, gets the pitch. Looks back at second. Starts his motion, kicks the leg and delivers. Foul tip from Hudson Mims. Go back towards the screen, throw to first. Credit the strikeout to Trey Carter, and that'll get the side out. Whenever we come back, Trey Fowler will take back over on play-by-play. The Flames and the Owls here on the KSU Owl Network.
Jimmy Johns is proud to support Kennesaw State University. Jimmy Johns is freaky fast, so your sandwich arrives freaky fresh. Order today at jimmyjohns.com or visit your local Jimmy Johns after the game. USA Rugby 7 Collegiate Championships is coming to Fifth Third Bank Stadium May 14th and 15th. Come see the best players from over 50 colleges compete here at KSU. Fast-paced action, far-away fan festival, beer garden, and more. Visit r7cc.rugby for exclusive ticket options.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Trey Fowler joined by Bryce Gobert. We head to the eighth. Flames on top 9-2. Let's revisit that trivia question and give you the answer. We had one guy try to answer the question, longtime Owl faithful, John. He cheated. He told me that via text that he did cheat. So we're going to give him half credit for at least making the effort and the initiative to try and get this answer. The question was, the Owls secured their first win over Liberty in the D1 era opening day 2015. By 11-9 final score. The question was, who closed the door on that victory and earned the save? None other than who got the trivia question right a week ago, or last time that we were here, Nathan Harsh. Nathan Harsh is the answer to that question. In that game, Kendall Hawkins got the win for the Owls, and home runs were hit by shortstop Cal Simmons, the Diamondbacks draftee, and Colin Bennett, who also hit a home run in that game. Owls won 11-9, first win over the Flames. They're hoping to add to that tally this weekend as the Flames lead the all-time series 11-3 and have a commanding 9-2 lead.
Now, Trey, real quick, I got a question for you. Is that cheating or is that using your resources?
I would say using your resources, but they tried to get me in trouble with that back in the day at trivia. So I think I was the reason they banned phones on trivia night.
Good to know that you were the reason for that.
That being said, we'll head to the eighth here. New catcher for the Owls is going to be Mason Jones, taking over for Nick Hassan. Slayton Otterman still on the bump and delivers a slider in there to Three Hillier for strike number one. Three Hillier on the night, one for two with a single, two walks. And F8 got the scoring started for Liberty in the first with a two-out RBI single to score Derek Orndorff. And the 0-1 pitch is a fastball fouled back to the screen. And that'll make the count 0-2. Also a new right fielder for the Owls, and that's going to be Joseph Gossett. So Gossett takes over for Edson, and Mason Jones takes over for Nick Hassan. 0-2 pitch, strike three on the outside corner, and Slade Notterman adds another strikeout to his tally as he gets his third of the evening to this point. And that'll bring up for the Flames shortstop Stephen Hill. Hill's got two hits on the evening, singled in his last at bat, a big hit with two outs to extend the Flames' lead at the time to 7-1. First pitch to him, breaking ball downstairs, misses. That'll be 1-0. Flames have scored seven of their nine runs with two outs this evening. Got it going in the first inning. As Three Hillier had that two RBI single, they scored four more in the fourth on the strength of two-run home runs. 1-0 pitches upstairs for a ball. The first by Brady Gulikowski, the Owl killer, his fourth in 2 years against the Owls. And the other by Derek Orndorff, who extended his A-Sun lead with his 13th home run of the year. Stephen Hill had the two-run single to make it 7-1. That one's upstairs right there, and it'll move the count to 3-0. And then a two-out, two RBI single by Aaron Anderson just an inning ago. Moved the lead to 9-1 before the Josh Hatcher solo home run cut it to 9-2. 3-0 pitch from Notterman upstairs, and that'll be another walk. The 10th of the evening for Owl pitchers, the 11th base runner that has reached by a walk or hit by pitch for the Flames. Logan Matthew now up with one on and one out. Matthew steps in the left-handed box, waves the bat over his head, and swings and misses an off-speed pitch from Notterman, who goes ahead 0-1.
Nice job there from Notterman to come back after giving up that walk with a good pitch. Get Matthew to swing at it. You got one out here, one strike. Just got to take it one pitch at a time.
Notterman coming on after another freshman, Miller Riggins, who followed starter Jack Myers, who went four innings this evening. The 0-1 pitch is popped up, third base side. Cash Young giving it a look. It's going to stay in play, and he'll make the catch for out number two. Nice job right there by Stephen Hill over at first base, going back to tag up. That's what you're taught to do at a very young age. Any ball that you know is in foul territory, you can't do anything else but tag up. He went back to the bag to tag up there, and had Cash Young not paid attention, We would have tried to sneak him into scoring position with two outs. That'll bring up Cam Foster.
Real quick, Logan Matthew very frustrated with himself after that at-bat. Slammed his bat in the dirt after that flyout.
First pitch to Foster's inside and brushes him off the plate for ball number one. Cam Foster grounded in a double play in his first at-bat. Reached on a leadoff error in his second at bat. That loomed large as the two-run home runs followed that, and he's walked twice since, on base three times. Breaking ball in there for a strike, evens the count at 1-1. Talked about it a little bit before. Scott Jackson really likes Cam Foster, as do many people that watch these Flames play. The Georgia product, someone they believe will have a bright future, especially now that he's back at third base. Breaking ball in the dirt, swing and a miss. Mason Jones throws down to second, and Stephen Hill's going to be dead meat at second base for the third out of the inning. So a nice block and scramble and throw there by Mason Jones eliminates Stephen Hill and the Flames here in the top of the eighth. We'll head to the bottom half here on the KSU Owl Network. Flames ahead 9-2.
Specializing in the metro Atlanta area and North Atlanta, they're dedicated to helping you with all of your real estate needs. Please reach out today at 770-401-0252.
We're back here on the KSU Owl Network. We head to the bottom of the eighth. Owls trailing 9-2, looking for some more offense. These two teams will play again in game two of the series tomorrow at 5 o'clock. And as of now, game three is scheduled for Saturday at 1 o'clock. It's expected to rain on Saturday, so there could be some adjustments to the schedule. Please check out KSU Baseball, KSU Owls online site, and their Twitter account, as updates will be made there should anything change and they have to play a doubleheader tomorrow.
At KSU Owls Baseball is the Twitter if you want to follow them and keep up with the team.
Mason Jones, who took over defensively in the top half of the inning, will hit to lead off here in the bottom half still against Flames pitcher Trey Carter. Carter pitching exclusively out of the stretch. And delivers fastball upstairs for ball one. Talked a little bit about it on the broadcast Tuesday night. The A-Sun has a unique setup for the conference tournament this year. Talk a little bit about that so the fans have an idea of what that looks like. Next pitch is up and away for a ball. The top the number one teams out of both the East and West division will go into one of the pools for the conference tournament. 1-1 pitch is outside, ball 2-1. And they will go in that pool with the two next highest RPIs, regardless of which division they're in. That will comprise one four-team pool. The other pool will be comprised of the next four highest RPI teams. The 2-1 or 3-0 pitch is in there for a strike, 3-1. And out of those two pools, the top RPI pool will, three of the teams will advance into the semifinals. 3-1's outside. That'll be a leadoff walk to Mason Jones. And in the bottom pool, the lower four RPI teams, one team will advance to the semifinals. The teams will then be reseeded again based off of RPI. One will play four, two will play three, and it will become single elimination from there, a semifinals and a championship game. You might ask, why the difficulty there? The A-Sun is trying to ensure that the top RPI teams play each other in the tournament and they don't knock a top RPI team out. The pitch, first pitch here to Joseph Gossett's popped up on the infield. Keeter settles underneath it. He has it for out number one here in the eighth. And they do that to ensure that the A-Sun gets at least two teams into the postseason, which is the goal. Gavin Patel come up now for his second at bat of the evening. He walked his last time up. First pitch to Patel. Breaking ball downstairs, bounces away from Betts, but not far enough for Mason Jones to try and move up.
Quick score update. Trey in the Central Arkansas versus Eastern Kentucky game. Bottom of the ninth. Central Arkansas currently up 13-9.
High scoring affair in that one. Fastball upstairs for a ball, 2-0.
Another quick update just real quick in the FGCU game, because that will have some implications on this series. Currently up 6-2 on UNF, top of the eighth.
2-0 pitch, foul back to the screen. Move the count to 2-1. So the goal is to try and ensure that the RPI stays high for those highest RPI teams in the conference tournament to get two teams in for the A-Sun Conference into the postseason. Next pitch is lined into center field, but Orndorff has a beat on this one. He'll make the catch and hustle it back in for the second out. Nice piece right there by Gavin Patel, but right at Orndorff. And that'll bring up Kalina, who is struck out in his three at-bats this evening. Very uncharacteristic for the Owls left fielder.
Orndorff did a nice job there. Took the first two steps back and didn't really have to move much further than that. Ball hit right at him, as you mentioned, Trey. Kalina looking to continue the inning here for Kennesaw State.
Flames lead 9-2. First pitch to Kalina. Swing and a miss on a fastball over the inside corner for strike one. Flames lead 9-2. Seven of their runs scored with two outs. Owls have two runs. But the RBI is coming off the bat of a two-out single in the first inning by Cash Young and a solo home run in the seventh by Josh Hatcher. Counts 1-1 on Kalina. Carter sets and delivers off-speed pitch. Really good changeup right there. Puts him ahead in the count 1-2.
Kalina really wanted that one. Put all of his swing into that, got off balance. Nice off-speed pitch to get him to swing on the 1-2.
1-2 pitch, another one in the same spot, a little lower, and that'll be strike three as Betts comes out, grabs it, throws it to Matthew to complete the strikeout. We will head to the ninth here from Stillwell Stadium in Kennesaw, Georgia. Liberty Flames lead the Owls 9-2 here on the KSU Owl Network.
Now pitching for your Owls is number five, Luke Cooper.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Owls trail 9-2, headed to the top of the ninth. On for the Owls is a new pitcher, Luke Cooper. He's 0-2 on the year with an 8.53 ERA, 6 1/3 innings pitched, 9 hits, 6 runs, all earned, 4 walks and 6 strikeouts for the transfer from South Georgia State. So, Bryce, we came on talking about the Liberty Arms matching up, who lead the A-Sun Conference in ERA, matching up against the Owls hitters. So far through 8 innings, it would appear that Liberty has taken the advantage here in game one.
Absolutely, and getting your starting pitcher to go 6 innings is absolutely huge. Garrett Horn did an absolutely phenomenal job, faced 27 batters, retired 9 of them, only gave up 4 walks and 1 earned run, threw 102 pitches, finished with a 1.62 ERA. Overall, the team pitching totals, both pitchers combined, and Trey Carter and Garrett Horn have a 1.9 ERA. Horn gave up the solo home run to Josh Hatcher, but they've done a really good job of shutting down this KSU offense. I mean, the only a couple of hits, and we're talking 5, compared to the 8. The Owls against Georgia had 14 in the top 4, and who's number 4 in RPI rankings. So doing a really nice job here, taking one game at a time. Foster going to be up at the plate here as he will have his at-bat return after hitting in it on a man caught stealing.
Foster back up to lead off the ninth as Hill was cut down by Mason Jones to end the eighth inning. First pitch from Cooper to Foster's in the dirt for a ball. 1-0. Cooper sets and delivers. That one's downstairs for a ball, and the count will move to 2-0. So Luke Cooper on. His first action since March the 22nd against Georgia Tech. 2-0 pitch. That one's right through there for a strike. Moves the count to 2-1. In that outing against Georgia Tech on the 22nd of March, one inning, 4 hits, 2 runs. They were both earned, 1 walk, and 2 strikeouts. 2-1. Downstairs again. He moves the count to 3-1.
Owls, just in case, if needed, have Harry Kane warming up in the bullpen.
Saw Harry Kane the other night against Georgia. The freshman had a really good outing. Only gave up the 2-run home run to Connor Tate. The 3-1 pitch is swung on and missed by Foster. Fastball down and away. Runs the count full here. Three-two pitch from Cooper. Lined foul and out of play over the first base dugout. We'll do it one more time. Cooper's had a couple of scoreless outings on the year against Jacksonville, Fairfield, Morehead State. The 3-2, swing and a miss. And he gets Cam Foster chasing a fastball up and out of the zone for his first strikeout of the night. And the first out here in the top of the ninth inning.
Trey, we're talking about it a little bit earlier with the pitching staff of Liberty versus the batters of Kennesaw State on the month, the powerhouse versus powerhouse matchup. Liberty currently 14-4. When the staff strikes out 10-plus batters, they have 11 tonight.
And you've given a lot of those stats tonight, and none of them have been in KSU's favor.
No, they have
not. First pitch to Gulikowski's outside for a ball. 90 miles an hour right there from Cooper. A lot of those stats have went against the Owls, but the beauty of baseball is it doesn't necessarily always matter what the numbers say. Anything can happen at any time, but you are facing an uphill battle when you're down this late against this Liberty team. That's a fastball across for a strike, evens the count at 1-1. Liberty had their 60-plus game win streak when leading after 6 innings snapped a year ago. And I believe that was by the University of Virginia. 1-1 pitch is outside for a ball. Moves the count to 2-1. But nonetheless, their record when leading after 6-plus innings over the last several years is a lot to 1. 2-1 pitch. That one's outside, and that'll make the count 3-1 here on Gulikowski. Gulikowski on the evening. The one hit, but it was a big one. Two-run homer to break the 1-1 tie in the fourth inning. And the 3-1 pitch swung on and missed, and that'll make the count 3-2. And the Flames haven't looked back since that home run in the fourth inning. Orndorff would add his own to make it 5-1. And then a couple of two-out, two RBI singles have the lead at 9-2. This one here has popped up on the infield. Who wants it? Looks like it'll be Cash Young, and he'll take it for out number two. So Gulikowski on the night now, 1-for-5 with that home run, two RBIs, and a strikeout.
Trey, I'm going to give you one more stat here. After losing a game, the Flames this season are 6-3. The Flames coming off a 10-6 loss against Virginia Tech.
First pitch to Keeter, swing and a miss for strike one. And that's the model of a great team, the team that does not lose back-to-back games many times. That's the mark of a great team. They can answer right back when they get beat, and the Flames are doing that this evening. 0-1 pitch over the inside corner for a strike with a fastball. He makes the count 0-2. And the Flames did that last weekend against Florida Gulf Coast, dropped back-to-back series for the first time in their A-Sun history. 0-2 pitch is grounded up the middle off Cooper's glove over to Cash Young. He throws, and that one's going to get away from Donovan Cash. And now Joseph Gossett falls down as he goes to pick it up, and Keeter will get to second base easily on that one. So score that one, an infield single for Nathan Keeter. Ball ricocheted off the glove of Luke Cooper over to Cash Young, who barehanded it but could not make the play. And that'll be the third error of the night and the second for Cash Young as Gray Betts comes to the plate. With a runner on second base and two outs here in the top of the ninth. The ball's lined down the left field line and out of play for strike number one. As we were saying, that's exactly what happens. That's exactly what happened last weekend as they swept Florida Gulf Coast, dropped back-to-back series for the first time in their A-Sun history against Stetson and Jacksonville, and then come right back at home and sweep Florida Gulf Coast to get right back in the mix in the A-Sun East. 0-1 pitch, breaking ball in the dirt. Nice stop there by Mason Jones. Will make the count 1-1. And it's their hopes that they head into Easter Sunday after a trip to Kennesaw, tied atop the standings with the Owls, heading into the second half of the season. 1-1 pitch. Downstairs, makes the count 2-1. Gray Betts 0-5, and I would bet to guess he has not had an 0-6 game in his Flames career. 2-1 pitch. Fouled back over the press box and out of play. Makes the count 2-2 here with two outs in the top of the ninth. Flames on top 9-2. Flames scored first. Owls tied it up. And then Flames scored 8 unanswered before the Josh Hatcher home run in the bottom of the seventh. The 2-2 ground ball just outside the third base bag. And foul as Betts did a nice job to stay alive, just reaching out and poking that one. Two-two pitch. That one just off the outside corner, and that'll run the count full on Gray Betts. Waiting on deck, Aaron Anderson. Couple of hits of his own on the night. Last at bat, two RBI single to extend the lead to 9-1. 3-2 pitch. That one's popped up on the infield. Cash Young settles under this one as well. He will make the catch, and that will end the top of the ninth for the Flames. They get one on but do not score. We head to the bottom of the ninth. Owls need a big rally to take this one home here on the KSU Owl Network. We are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Heading to the bottom of the ninth, Owls trail 9-2. Trey Carter still on the mound for the Liberty Flames, looking to close this one out. Should he do that, he will get the three-inning save here and make a winner out of the Flames and Garrett Horn, which would be Horn's fourth of the year. And he'll have to go through the top of the Owls' order, and that includes Josh Hatcher here to lead it off, who homered on off Carter, his last at-bat back in the seventh.
Trey, if the Owls do not come back in this game, their record versus left-handed starting pitchers will move to 4-3.
That one's fouled back and out of play. You always wonder about that and worry about that a little bit for a lineup that has quite a few left-handed hitters in it, how they're going to fare against left-handed pitching. A one pitch to Hatcher is an off-speed pitch. This one does not catch the strike zone to home plate umpire Mr. O'Shea's liking. Gauthier. 1-1 count. That pitch is downstairs. Another breaking ball that skips through there. Ray Betts does an unbelievable job of picking the baseball back there. He's got quite a few pickoffs, a runner at first base in his career doing that. A very adept skill that he has as a catcher. 2-1 pitch outside for a ball, 3-1. Betts started his career for the Flames as a left fielder, catching sparingly. 3-1 pitch, and that's upstairs for a ball, and Hatcher will start the ninth with a leadoff walk. Betts caught sparingly that first year, and that's because the Flames had the A-Sun Player of the Year, Jonathan Embry, behind the plate. That'll bring up Tyler Simon.
Owls looking to get the bats going here. It's currently 9-5, Liberty 16-0, and they haven't hit their opponent so far this season, looking to make it 17 here tonight.
Simon on base all four times, a double and three walks. Breaking ball in there for strike one. He doubled in his first at-bat, scored the first Owls run all the way back in the first inning, and he's walked three times since then. Once again, Owls looking to pass it down. And that one's fouled back and out of play, and Carter quickly jumps on top of Simon, 0-2. Hatcher takes his lead. Carter sets at the belt and delivers the breaking ball in the dirt. Nice stop there by Betts. Makes the count 1-2 on Tyler Simon.
Flames with a win here tonight would extend the series lead over Kennesaw all time, 12-3.
The pitch downstairs evens the count at 2-2. 12-3, Flames have had a lot of good success against the Owls, and you see that a lot across the A-Sun. The Flames themselves have struggled with the Dolphins of Jacksonville. You see that happen quite often. 2-2 pitch. This one's popped up back and out of play. Not a whole lot of foul territory here at Stillwell Stadium, so not many foul balls tend to stay in play, especially the ones that go up behind home plate. We mentioned one of those wins came on opening day 2015 for the Owls. The other one came in the 2019 season, game three of that three-game set, and the final came in the last game of last season. That's a ground ball to short. Hill has it over to Keeter for one, over to first. That will not be a double play as Simon beats that out. So fielder's choice 6-4 races Hatcher and puts Simon on first with one out for Donovan Cash. That game to close out the 2021 regular season here at Stillwell Stadium, in which the Owls won, was started by Ryan Kennedy. Now pitching at Virginia Tech, actually faced these Flames just a few days ago and had three shutout innings in that game. First pitch to Cash is downstairs for a ball. Makes the count 1-0. And 1-0 pitch. Swing and a miss on a fastball. Another one on the inner half there. Evens the count at 1-1. Carter taking no time, getting the sign and going. 1-1 pitch. That's a ground ball to third. Foster has it. Over to Keeter. Over to Matthew for a 5-4-3 double play. And that will end your ball game as the Flames take this one by a final score of 9-2. Makes a winner out of Garrett Horn. He'll move to 4-1 on the season. The save goes to Trey Carter. And we will be back tomorrow evening at 5:00 for game 2 of this series. Keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, check Twitter and the websites to ensure that the schedule stays as is. As of now, game 2 will be tomorrow at 5:00, and game 3 will take place on Saturday. Scheduled for 1, that time could be adjusted as well, but keep an eye on Twitter, keep an eye on both teams' web pages, and you will be updated on that. I'm Trey Fowler for my partner Bryce Gobert and our production team, Lucy Duncan, Aaron Cater, and Katie Klein-Peter. Thank you for joining us. Hope you have a great rest of your Easter week. If we don't see you watching our games again this weekend, I hope you have a very happy Easter. God bless you all, and we'll see you tomorrow night.